Hello. Hello, everyone. I just want to see if the chat works, of course, as well, as usual. And yeah, Mr. Ljubičić, very welcome to the channel. And you know that it's usually about chess, but certainly it's like my entire childhood, I was looking at tennis and at the superstars like you. And really, it's a big honor for me to have you here on the show. Thank you so much for coming.
Thanks for having me. I'm as you can imagine, you know, I'm a huge chess fan, so it works perfectly.
Yeah, thank you so much. And you know, guys, just that everyone that is watching the show now, Mr. Ljubičić is a huge fan of the game, and I never knew this. I mean, until recently, and I was impressed as well by his games. Actually, one of his games that we're going to look, during the stream, impressed me. And I even saw that maybe I have to check my notes, you know, like the chess notes and stuff, because it was like a first line in Neidorf. And I'm really impressed. But what is your level like? I mean, what is it like playing
in a
chess?
Good day or bad day?
Well, I mean, let's say the good day first. Yeah. Because well, on a bad day, I think it's the same, yeah, like mine.
Yes, on a bad day, it's bad. Yeah, no. I mean, I play mostly on League Chess. You know, I don't know. It's just I like the way it's set it up. And then I have also chess.com account. But League Chess, for some reason, I just find easier. And I play mostly. I mean, also time controls. There was a moment I played only bullets, which was not good.
Yeah,
but now lately the ones I like the most it's 5 minutes, 5+3 if I have more time, and 5+0, 3+0 sometimes. But for me, this is kind of, you know, it's not too fast, and it just gives me time, because I like strategy. Yes, that's why I play chess. So I don't like to be rushed. The level, it's you know, I think I can play 2000 level in the good days, and in bad days, you know, 1600. You know, but it depends also how much I'm into it. In periods, I play a lot. In periods, like for months, I don't have time to play. So it doesn't really usually actually correspond with the level. You know, I think I need to kind of be more. And I realize that more I watch, you know, like great games and the streams and people explaining, obviously, the more my level all of a sudden goes up. And the less I do that, and the more I play bullets and stuff, then the level starts going down. So more or less, I think I answer your question.
Yeah. I mean, yeah. But so it means that, like, I mean, let's say for you when you are playing. I mean, for us, I mean, I was playing tennis like for many, many years. It was like part of my like physical preparation for the chess tournaments. Even though that many people are asking all the time, like, even if you have to train in chess or something, or is it just you are coming to the board and showing like your best or something? But of course, it needs a lot of like kind of stamina, let's say, and I mean, to be able to focus throughout the game, like for 5-7 hours and so on. So I was training at first. I was training with my grandpa, and we were playing a lot of tennis, and he's like an avid fan of tennis. I mean, we have watched with him like all of the matches, all these Davis Cups and all that. I mean, like throughout my childhood and teenage years. And certainly he was the first person that I've messaged that we will have a stream with you. And he couldn't believe his eyes. He was so happy. And like, yeah, he said, like, I mean, you reached such a level and so on. And so, yeah, even more than when I'm winning the chess matches, you know, he was happy. So, but for example, if you are playing, I mean, for me, like tennis was kind of, you know, I mean, anti-stress as well. Can you call it an anti-stress, like the chess game when you are playing it? Because it's like completely different, and different emotions as well. Or is it just the kind of hobby just for the mind work or something?
Yeah, no, but for me, you know, how kind of everything started. I mean, of course, like all the kids, you know, in Yugoslavia back in the days, I'm talking about the 80s, you know, before the whole country collapsed, you know, we had this TV show, the chess TV show, where, you know, they would analyze games, and it was part of the culture. You know, everybody played chess at some level, you know, so you very early you learn the moves, and then, you know, I guess you have to really be passionate about it, or somebody really need to push you to kind of, you know, bring it to another level. But I didn't play a lot when I was a kid. Where I started really follow it a lot and I got into it was actually in my best years in tennis in 2005, 2006. but it was not playing. You know, I was buying those chess masters from Josh Whiteskin, you know, and what I would do for hours, I would put the CD in and I would just listen. It, for me, this was relaxing. You know, this was completely anti-stress, and how I got now, and then that I did for 3-4 years, it was not really playing, because back in the days, you couldn't really play online. And then actually in the tennis community, there's a lot of people actually playing chess, you know, the board, everybody's traveling with the board, and you can see playing chess in the locker rooms and the restaurants. I was not doing that. I was just, for me, it was meditating by listening others, you know, explaining chess and talking about games. And then I got hooked back again. Well, I don't know how many years is the goal. Is that maybe 3-4 years, maybe five, you know, with Antonio Radic, our friend Agat Mator, that I guess the Chinese community knows very well. I had no idea he was a Croatian, but I followed the same path. I wanted to listen to somebody talk about chess, you know, especially in the language that I understand. You know, now I understand also, you know, the grandmaster's language, but at the beginning it took me time to understand, and Antonio does a really good job by bringing chess, you know, to the let's put it this way, like normal people, you know. Yeah. And I really got hooked, you know, and I started to listen again and listen again, and then at the time, you know, I said, okay, let me open the account, let me play some. And so to go back to your original question, playing, it does not really relax me so much, you know, especially the faster the time control is, the more stressed I get. But listening, yes, absolutely. This is one way that how I unwind in the evening. I like to just lay down and just listen him, you know, talking about it. Or there is a lot of now online games that, you know, the grandmasters comment, and you know, Peter Swidler, it's one of my favorite, you know, the way he talks. Yeah. And of course, Grishchuk and all legends, Peter Leko as well. I mean, I was listening yesterday, I was watching Nakamura with MVL. It was a battle. So, you know, I just love enjoy really listening more than maybe sometimes playing.
Yeah, I see. And what is more stressful to you? Because I mean, I've met some players, like the professional, like, I don't know, hockey players and the different like football players and so on. And even if I remember right, but later we will talk probably about it. But one of the like many of the like huge sports persons, like, I mean, like really high, like in rankings and so on, like hockey, football and everywhere, they were telling me that from time to time, they don't understand. I mean, they couldn't understand how stressful can chess be sometimes, because, I mean, we gave them some of the puzzles at some point. And one of the players, I don't want to mention the name because I didn't have the permission to mention, but he was like really stressful after that. And he said that, I mean, it's like, man, it's more stressful than my top matches and so on. So if you are playing, I mean, this bullet game, especially bullet, because I see like the heart is pumping after each move more or less. And it's like so fast, you have to take the decisions, blitz as well. And especially, I think the heart rate is like super high is when you have some kind of winning position, then you spoil it. And you have to maintain this balance, you know, throughout the game, which is hard, certainly. And so playing is kind of stressful from time to time as well. Yeah, for you, even though you are like capable of taking the huge amounts of stress, like on the highest level.
No, but I mean, you know, we very often, you know, in the sports world, tennis community, we speak about pressure and stress. You know, this is something that is part of what you want to achieve, because pressure comes with when you want something, right? And when you play to win, there's always a level of stress. The more it's at stake, the more stressed you feel. So it's inevitable, you know. Of course, if you play a chess game that you don't care, you don't feel stressed. But if you play a chess game because you want to win and you want to work on your ranking, then the stress comes, you know. So yes, I mean, it's not, I don't, also like in my tennis career, you know, at the beginning, I was trying to, you know, I would feel nervous and it was uncomfortable and I would, like, see, you know, the people, like psychologists who can help me maybe feel less stress. And only later I realized that the way to deal with it, it's not trying not to feel it, but actually how to, you know, function with it. So, and then that helped me a lot, actually, later, just to say, okay, you know, I feel nervous. It actually, you need a little bit of this feel to perform, you know, if you don't care. Then you just, the performance is not there. You feel more comfortable, but the performance, it doesn't help your performance.
Yeah, I mean, you are not focused as well. Yes. Yeah.
So it's, you know, I do feel, I mean, I am tennis is individual sport, and every player who played at a certain level, it's individualist and competitive, and he wants to win whatever you play. It doesn't matter the game,
Yeah, and the same on the top level, because I've seen a lot of chess players, and when you start to play anything like even a table football or anything like that, you know, which seems like quite fun, you know, like you go with the pairs, and you have two players on one side, two on the other, but you see like the top players and like grandmasters and so on, let's say in chess, and they're like you know, so competitive there. Is it the same? It's the same, yeah, I guess for any sports.
Of course, 100%, exactly, and the same.
In this quarantine times, I think we're all more or less locked down around the world, but did it make you play more chess? Because for us, let's say, on my side, let's say I was, you know, I've started the YouTube channel, do a lot of stuff like for the chess popularization as much as it's possible, because otherwise, you know, when you are like probably in tennis, especially when you are on tour, you don't have much time. It's like preparation, then tournaments and so on. And in chess as well. So more or less something like that is happening. And in this case, I mean, it's certainly hard to devote yourself to something else rather than the tour itself, yeah. But for now, yeah, I mean, I found time, you know, for the YouTube channel, for this kind of stuff. I also went to Agat Matters, one of the first streams I went to. It was Agat Matters. We played some games, and one of his relatives is like the FIDE master or something. He made a draw against me in a blitz game, like cool one. Yeah, and so on. And yeah, so for now, I think it plays a huge role that, I mean, there is a chess, let's say, in my life, and I appreciate it even more than ever, because I mean, during these times which are hard for everyone, you have this kind of thing that you can do from home, even play the super tournaments like we do now, like for this Chess 24 Magnus Carlsen Champions Tour and so on, and it's a huge thing. But did it make you play more chess, or because I saw that you are playing with the kids and so on, like teaching them to play, but probably you don't want them to become professionals, or is it just for fun?
Yeah, I guess. No, but they're just, sometimes they're mad because I spend too much time watching chess and playing chess, you know, in my free time, because it's not a lot of free time, but they know of my passion for chess. This is clear. I played, you know, yes, there were periods, especially when that moment, and that we will talk about that game against MBL. I really actually, when I realized I'm going to play him, I really spend a lot of time, you know, studying, because I don't really, my goal is not to get as high as ranking as possible. You know, my goal is just to play and enjoy. Of course, that if I can improve in the process a little bit, it's always good. What bothers me really when I make a stupid blunder, it really, really, really bothers me. I don't mind losing a game, you know, to a good player, or like, I enjoy sometimes even playing a good game and losing, it's fine, you know. But sometimes when you just lose a piece, or you know, it's just nothing there, you know. So there was, is it, April, May was probably the period where I played the most. I played the best level for me was end of summer, like end of August, and also now. But it goes up and down, you know. And but I did, definitely this year I played more than any other years. I mean, but I'm not sure if it's only because of the pandemic, you know, maybe it's just my passion for chess increases naturally.
Yeah. That's so cool. And also, I think it's very important for the fans, yeah, because they see that, you know, chess is not as popular, of course, as tennis, and like especially as football, let's say, if we call it, because it's like always televised and so on. And you know that for chess is not an easy thing to be televised. Because some of the things, it's like a bit closer to art, or I don't know, some kind of science and so on. You have to explain. You need some kind of knowledge in advance, like, because with tennis and football, it's also very easy to learn the rules and understand what's going on. And with chess, of course, you have to explain, and you know, things. You have to kind of have some basic education towards the game, and then you can feel the entire beauty of everything. But for many chess fans in the world, I think it will help that. Such an important, you know, sports personalities like you, and like top players in other sports are, you know, having this passion. Because I mean,
I think chess is just I think everybody should know the move, like what the you know, how the pieces move, you know, this everybody, then you get passionate or you don't. This has nothing to do with that, but for me, it's a part of the culture, you know. Chess goes way back, you know, many, many, many years. So for me, when somebody doesn't even know how the pieces move, like for me, it's like, really? Like, come on. You know, it's like you almost have to, you know, it's like you drive, you know, riding a bicycle. You have to know. I mean, you can be passionate about it or not, but you have to know the basics, you know. So
That would be nice. Yeah, that would be nice. And have you ever played against some? Because I've seen Djokovic and Becker playing chess. There was some photo of them. I even shared it at some point when I saw it first time, like on the Instagram page and so on. But do you know that, have you ever played against them, or you were like on your own, just enjoying?
But the thing is that, well, I rarely played over the board. I just don't have time. Once, as you said, you know, once you're on tour, you have a routine that you're always going from the hotel to the tennis, then you play, you practice, then it's easy. You really don't have time to sit and then play. You know, it's not, I did not play against them, you know, and as I said, you know, mostly it's basically only online, and rarely we, like, you would have same free time at the same time when somebody else has. So I have not played, I don't remember that I played somebody from my tennis community against lately. You know, I just go online, I just click and whatever, whoever jumps in, you know, I'm happy to play with.
Yeah, I see. Because that's exciting, because I've watched some of the interviews of the Lennox Lewis, let's say, and you could think like what can be common, in terms of like playing chess and so on, like enjoying it, and like, let's say, heavyweight, super heavyweight boxing. And he was explaining so well on Joe Rogan's podcast, and he said, I'm also going to the site, I'm just playing games, like I can play all night and so on, just against the random opponents. And also Klitschko brothers, they're adepts of the game, and also close friends to many chess players, top chess players, and so on. And now, if possible, I would like to add one person. I will have to message him, and he was happy to hear that we will have this conversation. And let me just message him for the show. And So let's say in my case, when everybody was asking if I want my daughter to become a professional chess player, let's say, I would be happy for her to, like, I mean, she knows the rules and so on, but to play more chess, of course, and to enjoy the game. But I don't know, it's hard. It's a hard thing when you are professional in something yourself.
My son wants to play tennis, so I understand what you're talking about. And I'm like, really? Like nothing else? Just really tennis?
Yeah. So it's also hard. Yeah, I mean, to make your kids like professionals, and then you know the whole path that you went through.
It's almost better not to know.
Yeah, sometimes it's just this road you went through. Yeah, you don't want them to go through it. Especially, I can imagine in tennis, it's like a lot of injuries and all that stuff. And when you think about So
I was happy. I was actually lucky that I did not have a lot of injuries. It's just that it's a very lonely place. You know, you travel the world by yourself mostly at a very young age. And, you know, you play, you lose mostly because, you know, in the end of the day, you have one person who is not losing and then everybody else go home losing a game, you know. So it's not a simple environment.
Yeah. So there is a huge fan of tennis and one of the greatest world champions ever in the entire history of chess, yeah? The man who beat Garry Kasparov at his prime, and he's joining. So, Vladimir,
good afternoon. Hello. Good afternoon, gentlemen. I'm sorry, my internet connection doesn't seem to be great, so might be some interruptions, but hopefully everything will be fine. And my greetings to Ivan, of course, to Teimur. Yes, I'm quite a big tennis fan. My tennis career have ended some 15 years ago due to injury, of course, as it should be, due to some back problems. But frankly, between us, you know, I can reveal a secret. Another reason was a total lack of any, even a shade of talent in it or improvement. But I'm still okay. I'm still following tennis, of course, and I like the game very much.
So a little bit like my chess, basically, you know, also like no way to improve. You just enjoy it and you play it until you can.
yes. But at some point I could not really anymore, and I would have definitely played still. But yes, I still follow tennis events and the biggest matches, of course. Yeah. So have a lot of, I have some friends in the world of tennis, I am supposed to greet Ivan from certain Marat Safin. I don't know if you know him, but I wanted also to get him today, but he was, first of all, he's not that much in chess, but the main problem was that he is having his sauna session today. And he said, this I cannot postpone,
priorities.
But he sent his greetings to you, Ivan, and but I will have another secret guest, also a good friend of mine, and also not a bad tennis player. Let's put it mildly.
You know that, like for example, the Australian Open was always I cannot say colliding because we are not playing in Australian Open and they're not playing in Vikanze, but it was always kind of colliding with the Vikanze tournament. So we were there always. And it's like, I know many, many players, including myself, who were watching, on the screen, the tennis matches because of the time difference because of the time difference usually. And also preparing for our games. Exactly. And then there was this, there is a small room in Vikanze just in front of the playing hall where all the players, let's call it, they can relax there, but mostly it's like hiding because it's like so many people in the hall. Usually it's like the different groups are playing, a lot of spectators. Also, it seems like you are in the middle of the stage and so on. Sometimes it puts additional pressure. So everybody wants to go there, but there it's like, it was like pure conversation about chess, about tennis, of course, even though you are not allowed to talk during the games. But the arbiter saw that it's not about chess at all. Nobody is discussing positions.
Yes, I remember also very well that it was always the case that the last round of Vikanze top chess tournament was on Sunday. Yeah, and it was always at the same time as the final of the Australian Open. So, and quite often because of the time difference, I think that actually it was exactly the same time. I mean, we were playing, usually I would start watching the final. And then I had to go to play my game, which was a pity, of course. I would have skipped it, but unfortunately, that was the regulation. And then usually I remember that somewhere in the middle of the final, we had to start our games. And I think we were trying to get some news from arbiters or something. What is the score now? I mean, in the final. I remember it very well, yeah.
Yeah, that was crazy.
And of course, those nights, because I'm also a late bird, you know, when I prefer to prepare for my games in the late evenings. And I remember that was the case, yeah, because Vikanze is not in New York, you know, it's a kind of quiet place with, I don't know, 2,000 inhabitants. And so I remember those quiet evenings, if not to say nights, when I would have my computer, you know, on the table, and then the TV switched on, and I would go to bed at 3 at night or something. So I would keep on, watching Australian Open. And sometimes, frankly, if a match would be very interesting, yeah, I would stay until 5 or 6 in the morning because the main matches were, I remember, you know, sometimes would end European time like 5 or 6. So,
it's 10 hours difference. So usually the final starts at 8 or 7, which is morning in Europe, yeah. You know, so that collides, as you said, on Sunday. It's Sunday morning, always the Australian Open final. But early rounds, you know, if they are played during the day in Australia, that's the middle of the night. So
But we're not sure. Let's say, I mean, the tennis helps chess players achieve more. But what about chess? I mean, can it help tennis players achieve more?
Well, I think there is a lot of people in the tennis community that like chess. You know, I'm not sure if it can help or not. I mean, this is something that I all my life, I liked, you know, strategy in general. You know, I also, when I was younger, I would play Football Manager game rather than FIFA or Formula One or so. I didn't, you know, I wanted to have time. This is always, I just let me, you know, enjoy and think. And so strategy for me was always my passion. So that I guess it's a natural to end up in chess. Let's put it this way. But it's but lately, I mean, my passion for chess last 6-7 years, I mean, I follow every single tournament that there is. You know, if I have time, of course. I really enjoy, you know, also obviously now with internet and everything, it's much easier. You can also, with the engines, you can, you know, analyze, and you can really dive really deep into it. Even if your level is not super high, it's very enjoyable.
Yeah, very cool. Vladimir, there was a guest, your friend, and
yes, let's try to invite him.
I think he's there. Let me see.
Right, behind you. There.
Yeah.
Very good.
So Marat, actually, I saw very recently. I saw him maybe a month ago. We played some paddle tennis together.
Yes, I know that he's traveling a lot in general. Yeah, he's
He was here in Monaco.
Yeah. I think.
Yeah.
Now so he's in the other place, but yes. So he next time we'll bring him. Also, what I've noticed that I just noticed recently some interview of Rublev, yeah, the tennis player, and he said that they play a lot together with Medvedev, actually that they like chess both very much. Good. And that actually they're playing a lot of chess together, so maybe for the next session we can
Russian culture, I'm not surprised. You know, it's normal,
but I guess also in your culture it's very
I mean, as I was saying with earlier, you know, we had, when I was a kid, we had, you know, there was one TV channel, you know, there were not hundreds and thousands, you know, and we would have, I remember we would have this chess kind of programs, you know, it was, mm-hmm. it was part of the culture. Now, every kid in the 80s and, you know, knew how to move pieces, then you end up in a chess club or not, but you know how to move pieces, and everybody knew who, you know, the champions were at the time. But then I don't know, it kind of changed a little bit, you know, which I feel like it's unfortunate, you know, and I feel like it is part of something that everybody should know the basics. It's like, go to ski, go to swim and ride a bicycle. You know, these things you have to know, and also how to move chess pieces. You don't have to, you know, play well, but this is, for me, it's something that, you know, every kid should at least try and play a little bit.
Yes. I even showed the game to my children. I have two kids, daughter and the son. And so of course it's a very important part of just general education. Even if finally they were not that interested in studying it deeply, which is fine with me, obviously. I guess you would be the same, if your kids wouldn't be so enthusiastic about tennis, I know how tough it is.
Absolutely, yes. I was just saying, my son loves tennis. He wants to play, and
he does. Yeah.
But that's I guess it's inevitable also, because they grow up also seeing that all the time and seeing their parents passionate about it. So, you know, they. I think it's normal that they are there.
You know, with my kids, it's more like theoretically. I mean, they wouldn't mind, but once I start to tell them that they have to go and study lots of things and spend hours and hours on it, that somehow makes them cool them down a bit. That part is not really something they would like to do. But anyway, of course, it's very useful, because it just chess develops whatever. Will be, how long you study it, but it at this age, especially when you're a kid, it actually develops your thinking process and certain patterns. Yeah, so, and there is no harm, definitely.
Decision making.
By the way, Ivan, I always had this one question. I was always wondering, about it, a purely professional tennis question. I'm always wondering why, even top tennis players, why there is such a big difference in serve? Because I always thought that serving must be something rather technical. Although obviously, your height is quite important for it. But I've noticed that there is, some players who are brilliant, but somehow they just cannot serve, as well as some others. And to me, it's such an important element, in tennis, that I guess if you serve incredibly well, that just brings you to another level. Yeah. So, I understand, since it is the case, that there must be an explanation to it. But as an amateur, it looks to me like it is something you can really, just by hard work, you can manage to to improve seriously, but I guess I'm wrong. So I wanted to ask you about it.
Yes and not. I mean, it is very technical shot. You know, it's the only shot in tennis that it depends completely only on you. You know, I have seen a lot of, you know, kids and players, you know, who struggle with it. I mean, I didn't. I mean, for me, it was the most natural shot ever. And, you know, many times people ask, well, how do you do it? I said, well, it's very simple. You toss the ball and you hit as hard as you can. You know, for me, this was the thinking, you know, but technique is very important. If you have a bad technique, you cannot serve well. This is very simple. And sometimes, you know, the coaches at the early age with the kids are not as, you know, good teachers, or sometimes, you know, techniques in you know, if you start maybe play too competitive too soon, then the kids, you know, just let me just put the serve in and let's play. They don't spend enough time on learning how to serve well, how to have a good technique, you know. So it is very technical. However, it is somewhat complex. You know, it's not that simple because there is a coordination, you know, the toss, the hit, the legs, the rotation, the twist, you know, it's everybody can serve. That's not a question, but to really serve over 200 and 210, 220, then you really need to make it almost perfect, you know, to the perfection that the technique, it's so coordinated that you have to not only serve 220, but you have to do it for 5 hours in a row. This is the difficult part, and be accurate. But again, you know, if you serve hard, but the ball goes everywhere, it doesn't help you.
Yeah, that was my case usually. Yeah.
But
it was very strong, but it never actually, you know, it was,
you know,
never
Marat,
in.
Our friend Marat would always say, I always play well, but the court some days is just short. It's just, I don't know, it's just...
Yes, I can tell you one of the stories. Actually, it was also funny with Viktor Korchnoi. You know, there was a story. Okay, you know, he's a very legendary chess player, but he had always, so to say, a sharp tongue. Yeah, so he liked to. He was witty, but sometimes on the edge. Yeah. So I remember. Actually, I was even taking part in this tournament. It was in the 90s, and there was a local player who was supposed to be. I wouldn't tell the name, of course, and even the country, but he was supposed to be a talented guy by the country standard. Of course, obviously, it was clear to all of us he will not be a very top player, but he was a prominent kind of player. He was invited to play with the top players. Of course, he got beaten up quite badly. But anyway, at some point, Victor, he won a game also against him. And then there was a TV, you know, local TV. So they just put the camera in after the game, you know, and they asked him, Victor, what do you think about our young, talented player? So you've just played the game with him. So, and Victor, you know, in his typical style, you know, he said, you know, yeah, we played the game. Then we have analyzed together this game. And I can tell you, I was really quite impressed. You know, he sees almost everything. You know, this is an impression in chess when you saw that he sees a lot of it. Yeah, so he sees almost everything. And then a small pause, you know, but always one move too late. So it's something similar with this short court, yeah, with a small court some days.
Yeah, well, Safin was hitting it hard, but Ivan, you said about the serve, but you were like the one of the tallest players on tour, no? Like
in well, I'm 193. I mean, at least I was last time I checked.
It's not enough, yeah. It's not enough.
No, but it's some, a normal height, you know.
There are some more than two meters, yeah. Ivan.
Yeah, I think there are some giants, you know. So 193. I mean, I would say tennis general height went up lately. So I was tall at the time, you know, 15, 20 years ago. Now you see all the players are very tall, you know, Zverev, Medvedev, you know, they're all almost 2 meters. They're moving well. So that's a brutal combo, you know, when you have a very tall guy moving well, that's tough. So I was, you know, maybe a little bit above average, but if you see Nadal, Federer and Djokovic, they are 186, 188. This, I would say still for tennis, it's probably the perfect height.
Ah, so perfect is like 188, 186, yes?
I mean, it is a game of movement in the end.
Yeah.
You know, you can hit as much as you want, but if somebody's moving well, You know, I do believe that if you are taller than 195, it starts becoming a bit trickier.
Now I see. That was my problem. Yeah, because I'm 195, you know, so that's why I couldn't manage.
You can cut your feet off. Maybe it's going to help.
Okay, but good surf probably, yeah?
No, strong, very good, but never in, yeah.
The net is a little bit too high sometimes.
No, but I mean, it's like, it's a hard game. I mean, my greatest achievement was that in Baku, at some point when I just finished my training, the tennis training, I mean, there was some junior player, the junior player, and her father said, okay, I mean, there is no one left to play, and already she just wants to practice a bit and before going and so on. like, who is this guy? Let her play with him and so on. So I went to the court. I barely saw the ball, but somehow I managed to survive until it was like 5-4 and 40-15. But to be honest, I mean, she was like a junior player for Azerbaijan's probably juniors or something like this. Probably not that high of a, I don't know, of a talent or whatever you call it, but maybe not the best player or something. But then somehow I saw that I will be completely destroyed after I saw the first serve. But I was playing, you know, this amateur type of tennis, not really hitting it that well, of course, like the professionals do, not approaching the ball in the right way. And certainly my pace was far from great. But probably this what caused her to make some kind of mistakes from time to time, because I was playing this amateur tennis and the ball was always going, you know, like in a strange directions that she would never expect on her usual trainings.
And, different spins.
Yeah, I was playing like actually Karchinoy's chess style was my tennis style more or less. And so it was like spinning all the time, like, you know, all this strange shots, actually. I cannot even describe exactly what they were. But yeah, so my biggest achievement was that I outplayed her finally. It was 5-4 and 40-15. And yeah, I fought till the very end, like we're used to, like in professional sports. And finally, I won 7-5. But then father was shouting on her and she started to cry. And I regretted it my entire life until today. You know, it's like already, I don't know, many, many years past. I feel guilty about it.
Unfortunately, I don't know how it's in chess, but unfortunately, in the tennis community, there is a lot of crazy parents. I mean, this is something that I'm amazing. It is something that, as you said, it's difficult to watch sometimes, really.
Yeah. They are too harsh. But is it good to be harsh as a parent in this case? Because let's say my dad in chess, he was harsh. Yeah. I mean, and to say that I would regret it today when I achieved something in chess, let's say like some top level or something. And this would be unfair to say that being harsh was bad in my case. Yeah. Probably I was kind of lazy. Probably I was misbehaving from time to time as well. And he wanted to have like kind of super discipline, but at the same time, he was like kind of, you know, this kind of parent that would be really pressing you to do things when you were kind of escaping, because usually the kids are escaping this too much pressure and all of the trainings and so on. Especially chess is very specific thing to do when you are a kid, because everybody's playing outside, you know, and like they're playing football, they're having fun, they're sitting with friends playing the computer games. Like at the time it was Sega and Nintendo and stuff like that, and everybody was there. And yeah, so somehow in my case, I would say that I mean, I have to be fair and say that, I mean, it helped from time to time, I guess.
No, it does. I mean, you know, there is a line where it's too much and where it's, you know, of course, the discipline, it has to be there. You need to be pushed. But yeah. Being pushed and being harsh on you, I think that, you know, it's too much is too much. I was also pushed. You know, there were also days when I was a kid, but I would prefer to do something else. You know, there's no question about it. But I still believe that there is a way to, if we remember days, some specific days where our parents were harsh on us or tough or pushy, that means it was okay, you know. But if we remember like 5 years of nightmare, then it's too much. You know, because I think at some point, every one of us, you know, you push the boundaries. You want to, you know, stay with friends. You want to play football. You want to do something maybe, you know, a little bit. I mean, in my position, you know, as a tennis player, you're lonely. You're, you know, sometimes you want to do team things. You want to do group things. And, you know, also vacations. I remember, you know, we would go. The class, school class, would go on excursion, yeah. And I would stay because I had to play a tennis tournament. You know, it was not the pleasant moments.
Yeah, but still, you enjoyed it. Yeah, overall, you enjoyed it,
yes,
right?
Yes, yes, of course. But I had, you know, I think it is interesting. You know, we all start, I think, at least in tennis, the kids start play tennis normally because they like tennis, right? They see it on TV and they like the idea of being tennis, but they start playing tennis because of love. Sometimes you also have sick parents that they have a vision or to have a tennis player child, no matter what child thinks. But I think this is minority, I would like to think. And then it comes this age, 13, 14, when you really need to actually start pushing it and then become almost professional at that age, you know, really have to play every day and you have to put a lot of hours in. And that's where it becomes less fun, you know?
Yeah.
And then again, it comes back by the end of your career, it becomes again nice because you learn to appreciate, you know, everything that you went through, and you see it again as something that you like. And then obviously as you stop, then you actually like it even more so because it doesn't require the negative side of it from you.
Yeah.
And by the way, Ivan, personal question,
me
as a one professional pensioner to another professional pensioner, I mean, what was the reason why did you stop? I mean, when you... because I did also, you know, I stopped professional chess about a year and a half ago.
You don't even know how much I know about you, so don't even start.
Sounds scary, okay.
No, but I stopped. I was thinking about it for about 6 months, maybe a year, I would say, but it was more... In March 2011, I was like, end is near. You know, I was not thinking to stop, but I felt like I started to have some physical problems. Mm-hmm. My level dropped just a little bit. I was, you know, 20, 25 in the world. I used to be top, you know, I wanted to be top. And I felt like I could not go back up, you know. So it was in the end of that 2011, I became father for the second time. So two kids, you know, traveling with two kids, it would... You know, it was just be too much a little bit. And then I didn't practice really well anymore. I couldn't. And it was just kind of combination of things. And I was actually really happy and lucky to call it off in the right moment. I never regret it. Never. Mm-hmm. I felt like I was ready to do something else because, you know, I stopped. I was 33. So I knew that there is another one or maybe even two careers of something else after that. So I was very ready for something else. That was my thinking, and I just felt was the right moment. I didn't have like one particular reason.
Ah, exactly my story. Yeah, exactly. Yeah. Just.
But it was. I mean, for you, it was. I mean, maybe Temur can help us here. But it was kind of a surprise of the chess community, or it wasn't really.
I don't know. I didn't think about it, but I mean, I don't know how. It was a bit surprising, but for me, it was not because, as you've mentioned, I had the same feeling that, first of all, the most important was that I kind of stopped enjoying it so much. I mean, I like kind of lost drive. I like to play still, and I actually even now I like to play. I mean, I play some blitz sometimes, etc. But I somehow it didn't matter for me anymore. You know, that was a very strange feeling. Sometime starting from, you know, beginning of the year 2018. I mean, I would say middle of 2018. I started to feel like, okay, I'm playing the tournament. I go to a tournament, and even during a game. Okay, it's like I can play, but I can also not play. You know, I can also read a book.
There is no goal. There is no objective.
I mean, I kind of enjoy. I enjoy playing, but I cannot force myself to concentrate. Really, yeah. I started to feel like I just okay. If I lose, I lose. If I win, good. If not, it's also fine. And that's a very strange feeling. And then also, I lost my drive to work. You know, I was not working much. And then somehow I started to feel like it's probably a good moment because, and many other small things. And also, I felt like maybe I should stop before 70.
What is, but I'm curious, what is the difference between like playing or not? I mean, I don't know how to put this. But your life does change upside down the moment you don't play professional chess anymore, right?
Yeah,
it does. Yeah,
I mean, it does. It's just a routine more. I mean, in general, you know, the it doesn't change that much. I mean, it's more like daily routine.
You cannot, because... like, let's say you say, okay, you know what? I don't care anymore so much anymore. I will play tournaments, but I will not prepare. I will not. I mean, this is not an option, right?
But you know, it's the same like in tennis. Maybe not as much, but still, you know that once you just play tournaments and you don't work, don't prepare, your play becomes pretty. I mean, bad for your standard. Yes, so it's not even so much about the result. This I didn't care so much, I mean, already, but just that you start to play badly. I mean, and this is, you know, it's once you have playing well, yeah, you just don't enjoy the process anymore. I mean, the already clear that you're not going to enjoy the result, most likely, if you don't work. But if, when you stop enjoying the process at the same time, then it just like somehow losing sense.
Yeah, so, because people usually don't, I mean, in tennis, definitely, and I think also other sports, you always want to play. That's not the problem. The problem is the process, that what it takes to make you play at certain level. This is what becomes, you know, eventually too much.
Of course, yeah. And that's why now I keep on playing some blitz tournaments from time to time, just because in blitz you don't need so much preparation, and it's also rather quick. So more or less, it's like, you can still play on your reflexes, and they're still kind of there, more or less, So I can still play a decent level blitz, but maybe rapid, already worse. But classical, I just don't feel like, I have the courage enough and motivation to suffer for 6 hours, and so on. So yeah,
I never played a classical chess game. So
lucky
I don't know.
You.
But
lucky
I played 6 hours tennis match. I can tell you that.
Six is it the maximum, like usually six? I mean, without interruption, of course.
I mean, we had this amazing one.
I remember Australian Open.
They played for 3 days. I mean, this was crazy. But I think other than that, I think six and a half. It's the maximum or something. I think mine was five something, the longest. But that's not the tricky part about tennis. You know, you go on court, you have no idea how long it's going to take, you know, and this is also for the TV. It's a stuff, you know, there's a lot of TV companies that are like trying to make, you know, schedule it in a way that it's easy to schedule. But it is what it is. You know, you start, it can be half an hour, can be 3 hours. We don't know. And it's also for the people who come after. You know, the worst is that when the schedule comes out and you look at it and you're like, fifth from 11, you know, whatever, or fourth, even worse, because fifth, you know, you have a lot of time, but like third or fourth, it could be in 3 hours, but could be in 10 hours, you know, so you have to be ready at 2 o'clock, but then you end up playing at 9. And then this is one of the rough ones.
Yeah, I can imagine. But then you are stay kind of there, and you are trying to be more or less warm. Yeah,
And that's where you play chess. That's where
No, but I mean, how is it like? Just for as Vladimir says, like a professional tennis question. I mean, for chess, we know how exhausting it is after the 7 hours game. I mean, Vladimir certainly had like around 7 hours game. Yeah, like I had definitely. For sure.
I had even more once.
Yeah, even more. Yeah, probably. So I mean, what kind of exhaustion? Because I think it differs a lot. I mean, in terms of the physical activity. I mean, it's certainly super demanding in terms of the physical, you know, pressure that you put on, like, the entire body of yours is working there. Let's put aside the stress as well that is there, just the physical part. How exhausting it is. How is it just possible to, maintain the balance, maintain your, I don't know, just physically. I mean, it's like you should be dead after this. Because in chess, okay, I mean, at least bad emotions, good emotions, you just finish the game. It's super hard still. And it's like really hard to get over it. You need to spend your evening well, and the next morning routine is a bit different usually for many. Some just decide to sleep well and play without any preparation as well, and so on, like in chess, yeah? And for the tennis, I mean, and you have to play the next match, and let's say you have played the semifinals like this, and then you have to play in the finals or something. Okay, usually there is some break, yeah? Like the Grand Slams, there is a break for the ladies' final, and then you have the final after, like Saturday and Sunday, you play the final. But how is it possible to get back? I mean, after this, how is it?
Well, I mean, you do that all your life. You know, you're trained for that. You just know in the ATP tournaments, we play five or six matches in 7 days. You know, just it's a kind of routine. You just play every day. You know, in the Grand Slams, there is one day in between, sometimes two, depending on the schedule. It is tough, but you know, if you won and you have to play another game, if you have to play another game, it means that you won. And so you're happy to keep going. The fact is that most important matches, you will always play tired. You have to know that and you have to get used to it. We have extreme weathers in Australia mostly, you know, it can really become 45 degrees, 42. I mean, sometimes it's really brutally hot. In US, we have humidity. Sometimes it's just incredibly humid and difficult. Once I lost 8 kilos during the match. So it can be very difficult physically. I mean, you can end up in cramps. You can really not finish the match maybe sometimes. But yes, if you win, you have to be ready. You know, you have to try to recover as much as you can and you keep going. You know, it's not easy. But again, I mean, I don't know. I don't see it. You have to be fit. You have to be ready. You have to, you know, but this is what we do all your life. You know, it's something that you don't
get
really
used to, yeah?
Yeah. You get used to it. You just go, you know, and especially in the now in December, we have this preparation period where it's basically the only month in a year where there are no tournaments. So you just kind of rest a little bit. You take a week or 10 days off. You go on vacation sometimes. In this period, there are not many places. You know, the top players go to Maldives or Caribbeans or somewhere. You take a week off and then you practice. You know, you do a week or two of physical preparation only or mainly. You try to build some kind of base. I mean, what can you do in 2 weeks?
Yeah.
And then you play tennis for 2 weeks and then the next season starts and then you go. You know, so you don't really have a lot of time to build something. That's why what I spoke about earlier, the age between 14 and 18, that your this is where you actually need to invest to build.
Yeah.
Because once you're on the main tour, you just go. You don't have time to build.
Yeah, I know exactly. It's actually the same in chess. And when I give advices to young talented players, I tell them, okay, work now. Now you need to make a lot of work, because once you start having lots of tournaments, you don't have much time to work or to improve, you know, strategically. Yeah, you just kind of make a small
adjustments.
Yeah, but the best time to work is actually before you get into the, you know, top level. Then of course you also, but I mean, if there is something missing, a very basic, minus you have there, it's my
but is
experience.
That, is that the age when you start learning? Like, at what age in chess you? I mean, of course you learn about everything, openings, middle game, end game, and all of that. But is there the moment maybe where you actually focus more on one thing rather than the other? Like, I'm talking about now between 14 and 18. Is openings are not the first thing you try to teach kids? Let's say if you have to teach somebody who is 12 and 12, no. I mean, already I guess they can have a very high level, right?
Yes.
Yeah.
Yes,
yeah.
But you need openings as well. But it's not the main part of the work. And further you go, I mean, better you are. It's becoming more and more important. I mean, you spend more and more time on studying openings, because studying openings is also studying middle games and end games at the same time.
Course.
Yeah, because it gets up to close to 100% at some point, you know, when you're on the very top, basically. Yeah.
Yes.
I don't know, Timur, I don't know about you, how were you working. For me, yes, openings would take from some point on, well, at minimum 90% of my time.
Yeah. That was the case as well. That was the case, especially when I
started
later, playing.
Right? That's later.
When I started to play on, I mean,
of course,
I had
when you're
a very
top player already.
Yeah. Because when I had, like, let's say when I was playing this, you know, the juniors and all this junior championships, European and world and so on. Let's say with that, we were trying, and with coach I had at the time, but especially with that, we were trying to avoid preparation, because there were a lot of like really good theoreticians that were working with the young players. And so he tried to put like more emphasis on like kind of general play and be strong, like, you know, in tactics and all that stuff, like tricks and all this, rather than really go into some sharp lines in Sicilian and, I don't know, neither for beat other system. some kind of force stuff. So I was not, I was trying to avoid it. So I was playing like knight f3, g3, b3 stuff all the time, more or less.
Like and, I did, like I did my last years of my chess career.
Yeah, you did it all last year. For the same reasons, yeah. And actually, Vladimir did it on the highest level. I mean, against all the top players. All the top players. And yeah, in my case, it was like against the juniors. I was playing all this, Pillsbury stuff at first, like d4, e3, bishop, d3, f4. But once they learned how to put the structure, d5, knight, e4, bishop, f5, and everything, like, you know, is there in the center, and you're just a bit worse as white. I was trying to change it. So I started this knight f3, e3, b3. So at least I was not losing immediately. Was having like different types of super bad positions. But out of them, I was emerging as a winner because in tactics, I was somehow strong. I was playing the Stonewall as black, this Dutch Stonewall defense. And yeah, I also tried to play it on the top level. But then at some point, you know, in one of the championships already like under 18, I think I suffered a very unpleasant loss there. And in one of the very important rounds, because they just showed on the highest level and in general that you can start with knight f3 and you already do not have this opening, more or less. Like the entire thing is not working, because if you put now f5, e6 and d5, they go with g3 and d3. And yeah, then you cannot put the knight on e4, which was my only idea. I was implementing all the time. So that was really tricky.
No, but like for me, it's amazing now. I have two questions. The first one is it's not really the question, but like you have in all this, you know, obviously deep lines and all of that, you know, eventually the top players find deviation or improvement, right? With the engines today or whatever, but you can use it only once. I mean, this for me, it's amazing. You know, back in the days, it was different because without the internet and computers, you can maybe get away with it a few times, you know, before it's found out. But now it's just once, and then you have to find another, you know, and then you have to find another. It's just, for me, this was like, wow. I mean, in tennis, it's not like that. It's not like, you know, there is a specific shot you can come up with only once and then you can never use it again. You know, it's not possible. But the question that I have is that the bishop pair, right? At what level it becomes relevant? Because I'm hearing about it so much, you know, it's so important. Bishop pair. But I never, like, for me, it doesn't work. Like what, because I guess my level is not good enough, you know, but at what level bishop pair really becomes a powerful tool? I mean, I know that it depends on the position, all of that. I get it, you know, but is there like certain level where it becomes really, really relevant rather than before that?
Timur, what would you say?
Well, at what level it becomes, yeah, with the bishop pair. Actually,
well, when did you, let's put it this way, when did you start kind of, is there a specific exercise tool or that you learn about it, or it's just part of the game that you just know it's there?
Yeah, I mean, let's say if I would answer this, in my case, I think it was the childhood when I started to learn that, you know, that the bishops, I mean, like all this Baku chess school, let's call it like this, at the time, I didn't know much about the entire, like the Soviet school. It was part of the Soviet school. Let's be fair. Yeah. It was an entire Soviet Union and it was a Soviet school of chess, more or less. And to me, let's say it was explained like, you know, the Fischer's games and so on, that he likes the bishop over knight and all that stuff. And the bishop pair is like, you know, it's a deadly thing. And I'm sure also in many analysis, I think like, you know, analytical stuff that we were doing, like, let's say with Vladimir and Garry Kasparov and Linares, when they were analyzing, once Kasparov would get like some kind of bishop pair, and he would find that his position is good, he would say like, oh, do you disrespect the bishop pair or something? Like he would always ask this kind of question. Yeah. Like, how can you disrespect it? And they were even giving pawns all the time for this kind of two bishop pair, like two bishop pair, not the bishop pair. Yeah. And getting this kind of play and the entire kind of Baku school, they were teaching us that, you know, this bishop pair is deadly. You can even sometimes sacrifice a pawn and then play with the bishop pair and so on. It gives you so much of a compensation because the bishop pair, the thing is that if you have these two bishops, I mean, one is certainly the dark squared and the other one is light squared. So it means that if they work together, they're controlling like almost the entire board. They cut it more or less. Yeah. So if you have like the end games with two bishops, usually, I mean, you are having an advantage. And if you are having like, you know, some kind of attack with two bishops and so on, it's also usually like kind of deadly. Yeah, I mean, depends on the position, of course.
Of course,
I cannot say that there is a certain level when it really plays a huge role, because sometimes nowadays I can get the bishop and the knight, and it depends on the position, can be much better than the bishop.
Maybe the question should be more different, like at what level you expect players to know how to take advantage of having it or not having it.
Well, you see, yeah. There are different levels of making use of it. So it's hard to say. I mean, basically, it's quite important to learn all those things as early as possible and to try to make use of it. Yeah, to try to. But then, I mean, in general, it's like your level is growing. You are playing better and better, and slowly all elements are improving, and also your position is becoming stronger and stronger. So in a way, I would say that you have this bishop pair, and you are, when you are a kid, yeah, let's say you are ready to show your opponent how good you are at with those bishops, but he just blundered a piece in one move, yeah, so you don't have a chance to do it. So I mean, slowly you get, you know, you get to to improve your opponent position, improve, and then, but in general, yeah, I would say bishop pair is one of the possible elements. We can talk about general positional elements, yeah, all sorts of positional elements, and yes, so it's slowly, I mean, better you are, yeah, slowly you, but for you, Ivan, I would say try to do it on your level. I mean, just try to play. That's what I've learned also about tennis, that, you know, when you play tennis, I'm totally unable to do it well, but you should try to play as if you are Federer, you know, Nadal, yeah? I mean, that's, and of course you fail, but in general, try to play the right chess, so to say.
I don't like to fail.
You mean we should try to play it like Nadal and Federer, because yes, Ivan certainly knows how to play it on that level.
Yes, that's what I mean. That for me. So for you, other way around. Yeah, try to play as if you absolutely know exactly how to make use of two bishops or anything else.
Yeah, Ivan.
And
in
one
few words,
day,
yeah.
You might manage. Yeah.
Ivan, in few words, there is no certain level, but it's one of the things that you have to master. It's hard to say exactly, to mention the exact level, yeah, because some players may be superior at it at, let's say, 1800 or 2000, it doesn't matter. But certainly, if you want to master the bishop pair, I think usually, I don't know, Vladimir was always good. I mean, with of course, all the top players are good with a different type of, you know, the material imbalance or balance and so on. But let's say for the entire chess community, we can say that maybe the bishop pair is like Fischer's bishop pair is like kind of classical or something. Yeah, and in general, the play against the bishop against the knight and all that stuff as well. Like he probably nowadays players would keep this position, but what he did in his time, in his prime, against like Taimanov and many, many other players, I mean, was kind of cool, yeah. It was something new, something like of this new engine era, something like that we can call it. Vladimir, there is a guest, and maybe you should introduce him. He's a Davis Cup winner with the Russian team, tennis team, and Ivan certainly knows him well. So yes. Can you introduce him in a few
words? Hello, Dmitry.
Hello.
So finally, you've managed, yeah, because I think you're suffering with internet, yeah, and...
You guys are talking about mastering bishop pairs. I'm trying to master.
But we wanted to ask you about the bishop
pair.
How is it going? How do you do with a bishop pair? Usually.
You know, I'm well, I just, you guys are putting me to sleep with this discussion. I mean, I feel like, I, you know, it sounds like a little bit like, at which level do you learn how to volley? And you probably don't really have that kind of like a certain level. You know you just kind of probably, you know, as you get better, you start learning about things. But
how do I play serve and volley and I cannot even put the serve in, kind of?
but you know what I mean, it's like I think to them it seems like very similar. You know, if someone just asks like, at which point do you learn how to volley, like, well, you know, you probably learned it in juniors, but there isn't, you know, you learn things as you go along. And And, you know, it didn't sound like they quite got the bishop pairs either. You know, I think they're still learning about it, which is why the kind of the answer is very vague. And it's not like well, 2400, that's where you learn about the bishop pairs. And
yeah. Oh, so.
And yeah, I wanted to ask because I think that both of you, Dmitry and Ivan, you after the end of your career, you also are coaching, yeah? I mean, at least some sort of...
Is it a question or a known fact?
No, no, it's a fact. But I wanted to ask you, how do you find, I mean, is it very different? Is it, you know, I mean, more enjoyable, less enjoyable, or it's just you cannot compare it or... I mean, do you feel this adrenaline as well? Or, I mean, just your experience, if you might. I mean, that would be very interesting for me because I'm also helping some junior, very talented kids sometimes with advice or with some lectures. So it's very interesting to know your opinion about it. I mean, your feedback.
Are you helping them in tennis? okay, so age before beauty or the other way around? Who's answering?
No, yeah. Ivan, let's say, yeah, you are the boss, yeah?
You are the boss.
You are the first. I mean, you are the boss of the stream, yeah? I mean, you are from the beginning, so you have the right. Yeah. For the
yes.
He's got answer first.
Yeah. No, but I mean, for me, it is as close as it gets to play. I mean, without playing, of course, it does bring adrenaline. You know, you do dive into it. You do feel nervous before matches, also coaching, you know, and you do get into it completely. You know, it's not the same because, you know, once the match starts, at least on the men's side, there's nothing you can do. I mean, you just watch and try to cheer your player up and hope for the best, you know. Thinking and hoping that you prepare the matches in the best possible way, but yes, it does give you that adrenaline. It does give you not all the matches in there, but you know the big matches are you know you sweat, you sit there and you start sweating. It brings a lot of adrenaline.
But I would actually contest your statement that there is nothing you can do during the match as a coach because I've seen some videos. And Dmitry, and they were quite.
For Russian speaking audience, especially, they were like kind of convincing. Yeah, let's put it.
Yeah, they were quite convincing. Yeah, but
there's a difference between men's tennis and women's tennis. You know, the girls get coach on the court sometimes. You know,
And in men's tennis, you are not even allowed.
Nothing is allowed.
Okay. I thought it's just that the players they don't want themselves, but. Okay. So it's not allowed in general, yeah. But Dmitry, so what is your...
approach.
I mean, or maybe you can just translate for our English-speaking audience some of your speeches.
Anyway, it's 18 plus.
Let's be serious. Just tell us about your experience. How do you feel it and...
Yeah, well, I think the difference between men, like men don't like to ask for directions. So, you know, that's why the coaching is not allowed. They're like, no, I got this. I know what I'm doing. And you just take it to oblivion. I think it's actually a lot of fun. And I feel like when you're younger, you really think you know everything. And at least that's how I felt. I can't speak for everyone, but I think as you get older, you start understanding way more about the game than you understand when you're younger or when you're a junior. And then by the time you start understanding what you're doing on a court, now you really, sometimes you cannot execute it. So, you know, kind of the youth is wasted on the young, as they say. And so now I think I understand a lot more about the game and so it becomes interesting to learn, things about the game and you're able to process it from the outside. So you're obviously less emotional. I don't get too nervous on the sidelines. Well, because frankly, it's just, you know, it doesn't really affect me in any way. I mean, obviously I want the player to win, but but I'm way less emotional and stress out way less than when I was playing. So
you mean that you haven't broken any racket yet, yeah, as a coach?
While coaching.
He doesn't have, yeah? He doesn't have.
Yeah.
You broke the pen now.
Yeah, I think Marat was telling a story about how Kafelnikov was playing doubles in Barcelona and his partner serves a double fault and Kafelnikov breaks the racket. So I don't do that when I'm coaching. But I do get a little, you know, pissed sometimes, like when, you know, when you say, just don't hit to the backhand. And the person is just doing completely the opposite, then you just start losing your mind. But I do get emotional in that sense. But it's kind of interesting for me to analyze how I feel about it because, you know, I think when I was playing, I would get, you know, way more. I think just get more upset about the losses. Now I look at it, you know, from a more philosophical point of view, like, okay, well, you know, we lost, but, you know, I think this is the reason why we lost. And to me, it seems like very clear and logical what we can work on most of the time. You know, and most of the time, it's just like basically do as I say, not as I do. So it's very easy to in that sense, you know, just look at my videos and this is what you're not supposed to be doing. But I think it's still a lot of fun. I think that the time when I was not, coaching, it felt like, you know, I was way out of, I felt like fish out of the water. So it's a lot of fun to be in that environment. And I feel like it's, you know, it becomes part of you and it becomes part of your lifestyle. And it's really hard to let go of it. Even if you are not interested in playing it anymore, you still like to be involved in it. So I know there's a lot of players who sort of, you know, walk away from tennis and then they go into other things. But for me, it's a bit hard to understand how you could do that. I think it's just kind of part of the game just gets ingrained into your DNA. So it's a lot of fun.
Yeah. Ivan, are you strict as a coach? I know that many things probably you cannot disclose, of course, but I mean, in general, like, are you strict as a coach?
I am quite, yeah, I like discipline. Yes, absolutely. You know, especially with the younger players, you know, when you here and there, you know, you have to discipline. It's important because without discipline, it's very difficult to get progress, in my opinion. So, yeah, I think so. I mean, but for this, you need to ask the players that I coach. So
Yeah. But I mean, let's
but
say, for example,
if they don't really follow, I mean, if they don't like discipline.
Yeah, but, you know, I mean, now with Roger, it's a different. We have different level of communication. And it's not that I am a coach, you are a player, you need to do what I say. It's more kind of the same level conversation that we talk together about the strategy, of course, because his experience is enormous. And then he also has his input. I have my input. Severin, the other coach, has his input. And then we come up with a game plan. And then he tries to implement it. You know, there is not, you know, I think this and you think that, and it's a bit different. You know,
I mean, in this particular case, definitely. But as far as I know, you've been working earlier with other more younger players, a few years ago. So I guess there was sometimes a situation when you felt like there is a certain miscommunication or misunderstanding,
yes the players do have this tendency to kind of lose the game plan or lose the objectivity of the situation, you know, that they focus on something completely wrong and they forget what the strategy was at the first place, you know. Mm-hmm. And or sometimes you just have to adapt to the situation, because especially at the high level, you know, it's rarely you have a big weaknesses. You know, it's a combination of things, and you just have to sometimes adapt to what you have, because there is a general kind of profile of a player. But then every day, you know, you have a daily form. Somebody, you know, today doesn't feel the backhand. You have to realize that as you play. You know, there's nothing I could have anticipated before the match that, you know, this particular player today, his backhand is not going to work as usual. So you have to take advantage of that. So that's why it's important also for the players to think themselves as well, because you will have to make decisions on the court by yourself.
Yeah, of course. But I mean, the big difference is that compared to Dmitry, for instance, that you cannot influence. Yeah, you cannot pass any information to your to your player. And,
it'd be hard, no? Yes. If you especially have something in mind, yeah, that you want to play. It's also hard, yeah, because you have as a coach, let's say you see something that he has to do, let's say during the game. And
yeah, but you know that I'm against the idea in general, because I feel like I remember when I was playing, and if somebody shouts something from outside, you know, why do this or why do you, then you have, you know, for me the match is like one line that you have to follow. You know, if somebody breaks it and it gives you some ideas that you didn't think about, it confuses you only. And so that's why when I was playing Davis Cup, which is, you know, the coach is actually sitting on the chair. It was the only moment in my playing career where actually I would have a coach who can tell me something. You know, I would ask him, please don't just leave it to me. You know, like what you said before, don't give me directions. You know, so I felt always comfortable kind of figuring it out myself. You know, but I don't know. Maybe it's also the what you're used to do. You know, and you would feel just uncomfortable all of a sudden that somebody is gonna tell you what to do. If you're not used to it, it's tough.
There is a question to three of you, actually. I mean, how many chess tournaments? Because, I mean, also to Vladimir, it's different, because I will not ask him how many chess tournaments he visited. And certainly for him, it's like about tennis. But how many tournaments have you visited, Ivan and Dmitry? Dmitry, so who starts? Ivan starts or Dmitry starts, doesn't matter.
Dmitry this time.
Okay. I only visited one. I went to watch Vladimir in Moscow. Was it December?
Yeah. When we had this Blitz World Championship.
Rapid and Blitz World Championship. Yeah.
So, it was pretty hard to, because I was running around this big room trying to find where Vladimir was sitting. And by the time I get the match is over, I'm like, you know, and then they have time out and, you know, Vladimir's out, like taking, you know, having a little ciggy. I don't know if anyone knows that he sometimes.
but sometimes I would come to you, we would just chat, and you would always ask me. I remember it was kind of similar, always conversation. Ask me, how did you play? I won quite a few games. I'm going to start losing very soon, you know, so don't get too excited. But finally, it was a successful event, yeah. Maybe due to Dmitry's support, who knows?
I was coaching from the sidelines, you know, just like on WTA. We had exactly the same chat.
But he was not following. He was not following your directions, as far as we understood it.
No, he
had his game plan in advance.
I was telling him, like, you got to master the bishops,
That's cool.
I went to London, Carlsen, Caruana. I was there because it was during the finals in London, and I got invited, and I went one day. But it's just tough. I mean, I don't have time.
It was November. So you were there with the O2 Arena. It's actually is the only time I was able to normally properly visit the tennis tournament, like professional tennis tournament. And so I went there to this O2 Arena and watching Federer play against Djokovic, and then I went to the other match as well. And so, I mean, for me, it was a big deal, because for many, many years, something was exactly colliding with one of the tournaments I would be happy to watch, because Australia is kind of far, was always hard, and there was Vikanze all the time. And the only possibility was for me to visit, I mean, I'm talking about the Grand Slams, the Roland Garros tournament, which is like in Europe, it's always like kind of close, it's easy to go there and so on. And anytime I would buy tickets or prepare the trip there, there would be some invitation to some chess tournament, and like the one that I actually have to play anyway, because I'm a professional chess player. I mean, and I was always skipping it, and still it's my dream. And now with this pandemic, I'm afraid that it's not ever going to happen, because you're playing without spectators, as far as I understand now, right?
Well, at the moment, yes, but looks like it's going to get better, hopefully. We need people.
Yeah. And Vladimir, how many tennis tournaments have you visited? Like the Grand Slams, maybe?
Me? Sorry?
Yes.
Because I had a small internet breakage. I've been quite often to Roland Garros, because first of all, I lived, I used to live in Paris for 10 years. Yeah. So yeah, quite many matches in Roland Garros. Of course, Roger Federer's match, one or two. I've been in the
Nadal, maybe.
Yeah, the semifinal of Djokovic-Nadal. I remember it was five sets. Yeah, finally Nadal won. What year was it? Maybe like, I don't know, 2000.
That was recently.
I mean, recently, like 2015, maybe or something. Yeah. Yeah, yeah. So, and a few more events, but yeah, I remember then I went just to see Dmitry maybe a couple of years ago, yeah, when you were coaching, yeah. And I saw a match of Arina Sabalenka, and yeah, so from time to time, I have, I think in Moscow a long time ago, but I remember actually with tennis, I have two very memorable, you know, experiences watching tennis. It was, both was TV. First, actually, was my first ever match. I've watched a tennis match, and actually, that was the beginning of my interest in tennis. It was the final of, you know, when Becker, he won his first Wimbledon, I think. It was like 80s, yeah? End of 80s.
85.
Yeah.
And that was, and it was showing by on Soviet TV all of a sudden, because usually they were not showing tennis, but since he was a kid, you know, he was like 17, Boris Becker or something, yeah? I remember very well, and of course, everybody was rooting for him, and then they showed it on the first channel, on the first Soviet channel. Or Russian, yeah, at that time, and that I remember that was my first experience, and then was quite an amazing, actually, shock for me. You know, that stayed very, you know, deeply in my mind, because of course, since 90s, I started to play a bit tennis, and I started to follow and so on, and then the big shock was semifinal, if I remember well, sometime end of 90s, maybe like 97. Semi-final of Davis Cup, and it was Russia against United States. So Russia was very strong at that time because we had Kafelnikov, who was at his prime, and then we had Chesnokov, Olkhovsky, yeah, different players, which were already, of course, a bit weaker. And I remember that they had like 2-2, I think was the score, if I'm not mistaken. And okay, so Kafelnikov actually beat Agassi, I remember, and beat Courier. Then Olkhovsky, maybe, or Chesnokov, don't remember, he lost his match against Agassi, and they lost the double also. And so the fifth match, and I remember, okay, not big chance. And then I remember all of a sudden I'm watching it and I see some young guy, they put some Marat Safin, you know, some young guy, I've never heard of him, 17 years old or something. I mean, at that time I didn't know it at all about him. And he plays Jim Courier, I think he played in the most important match. I was kind of wondering, you know, why all of a sudden the trainer, you know, he put this young guy who is, yeah, I mean, you know, there was a choice, Olkhovsky, Chesnokov, I mean, there was some choice, yeah? And all of and I start to watch, you know, 6-0 first set, I remember. And okay, but what is this guy, you know? And immediately it's become clear that this guy is going to be someone, yeah? Because it was not really because the Courier was such a, you know, playing badly, but, you know, it was just amazing because Marat was just hitting extremely hard and like every second hit was a line. Not even very deep into court, but line. I mean, this poor Courier, just 0-6 without a chance, you know, the first set. And I remember even he won his serve in the second set. And then finally, he won his serve back. Yeah, so his first game in the match, Jim Courier. And I remember he even, you know, raised his hand after that. It's like, you know, finally I managed. Yeah? He won in five sets finally, Courier. So we lost this match, but that was really kind of quite an impressive experience, which I remember very well. And then, yeah, maybe another one was 2000, the final, of course, also Sampras against Safin, yeah, in New York Open. That was also very impressive because I've been preparing for the World Championship match against Garry Kasparov, which was starting just a month after. And it was in a way, it was quite similar.
Exactly to 20 years ago, yeah, actually.
In 2000, yeah. And I remember it was very inspirational for me because it was the same story. Sampras playing in New York in incredible shape. Clinton came to a match, I remember, you know, Bill Clinton. And it was like, you know, he's going to win. And of course, everybody understood Marat is strong, you know, talented, but still, you know. And then all of a sudden, he just played some amazing tennis, absolutely amazing. It was one of the maybe best matches I ever seen. And just, I mean, Sampras was still extremely strong, but the guy, I mean, Marat just was doing some incredible things. And that was also very, in fact, inspiring for me because, yeah, I felt like maybe I can also try to do something similar, yeah, which I did in a couple of months.
Yeah, but like Marat, Marat at the time, I mean, it was really impressive for us. I mean, it was like, I was telling Ivan already that about my grandpa and like, he liked him so much. I mean, when he appeared at first and, you know, he was telling me like what a superstar he is. And actually when the first match he showed me of Marat, I saw the match and he was hitting like the backhand. I don't know what's the exact professional word for that, but he was hitting it with two hands, like the backhand with two hands. Yeah. Two-handed backhand, how is it called?
Yeah,
that's correct. Right. Yeah, and I could barely see the ball after this. I mean, I was just, listening to the arbiter, yeah, if it's out or not, but it was like, you know, just leaving the arena, yeah, or something like that, so strong. And that was really impressive. I can understand Vladimir's feelings about it because when I saw him...
I've seen a few matches of Dmitry also, I mean, on TV and definitely of Ivan as well, but I have never seen live both of you, I mean, on the court.
Dmitry was not really nice on the balls.
Yeah. But you had some super long match, yeah?
Did you, I mean, what is your personal record of two of you, if you ever played?
Well, yeah, I remember the big one we had in Wimbledon with Dmitry won. I had a match point, and it was that's probably the one you think about. It was, I'm not sure. I think it was 2007, maybe.
Yeah, I don't remember. But we actually, I think we played twice. Lost to Australia. Because a while back I was looking at my all my matches and so the one in Wimbledon I won, I was down two sets and I remember I started chipping returns because like I couldn't do anything with the serve, so I was like, and it was one of the first times when I ever started chip slicing the return back because the topspin just kept going into the royal box and so that didn't work for me. But yeah, I was so proud of myself because I made an adjustment. You know, typically I didn't like to adjust too much. But
first and last time.
Yeah, you know, do not change.
They have started the professional language is there. So can we talk about some Queen's Gambit start with Bishop F4?
No, it's very Rusey interesting. Yeah. I don't know. Yeah.
You had your conversation, okay, with the master. Pairs.
No, actually, it's really, really very much honored to have you all on the stream, and that's really so nice of you coming. Thank you so much. It's so pleasant. It's not the finish. It's just the fact that I really appreciate you coming. And have you watched the Queen's Gambit, by the way? Like to all of three, it goes to the question.
Yeah, I saw it. Yeah, of course.
What was the impression? Who do you think is kind of depicted there, if you can call it this way? Like, who is the person you think about when you watch it? Because it's a lady playing chess and getting to the top of the world of chess and so on. So who do you consider it is?
Oh, of course. I mean, you have to think of Judith, right? But it's, I feel like it's a combo of few characters in real life. You know, they put couple, figures and the persons in there, So, of course, it's a fiction, but I can see it that it can be somewhat realistic. It's not something that cannot ever happen, because Judy did it. I mean, she proved that it's possible to compete with the best, and of course the whole story that made it her losing her mother and all of that is just it made it very appealing to the general public. But I'm happy to hear that chess got a lot of attention since that, because it's really serious, very well done, and it's always nice to see, because obviously you don't have to be a chess expert to understand the series, but they also used some interesting and games in there to be part of the show, and I was curious, whose games they actually picked to analyze. Yeah. and to actually made of, and I was it was incredible that it was actually Vasily's, Vasily was the name of the Borgov, and then they also used Vasily's game. in the finals. So that was fun.
It would be complicated for them, because I mean the Kasparov was consulting the series, I think.
Yeah.
And certainly picking the games against Kramnik would be hard. Hard thing.
No,
to do.
But actually one game of mine is there as well.
There was one.
Yeah, yeah. I haven't noticed it, but somebody have sent me a picture, and when they play these blitz games, yeah, in a cafeteria, and is beating Hub. Yeah, one of the games was actually my game against Morozevich in 2007 in Mexico. So obviously I haven't noticed, but they sent me a picture. I had a look. Yeah, it's my game.
Have you watched the series itself?
Sorry?
Have you watched the series itself? Like the...
Me, yes, I had to. I mean, usually I do not watch much. I don't really have time, first of all, but okay, it's our professional thing. Yeah, of course I did. Yeah. And Dmitry, did you see it? Did you watch it?
No, I don't have connection half the time, you know. So
can download and then watch it later.
Well, yeah, you need a Wi-Fi for that, and that's the one that I've been.
Where are you now? You're in some in North Korea or
dark places?
Yeah, no street lights and I haven't watched it, but I did watch a movie about chess with. Young girl in Africa, becoming
I like the Queen of Chess. Yeah, I think it calls or something.
I think something. Yeah, yeah.
Uh-huh. Yeah, I like the movie, and I believe it was based on the true story.
Once you get decent internet, Dmitry, I can recommend you if you ever manage. Yeah, but
Queen of Gambit,
right?
Sorry.
Queen of Gambit cafeteria scene. That's the one I'm looking for.
No. The Queen's Gambit. It's on Netflix. It's actually, now, I think, the most popular serial this year on Netflix.
Yeah. It was like 60 success. Million households and they watched it.
You have to watch. Dmitry, you have to watch the 7 episodes. Don't just look for the episode where there's cafeteria. Come on.
No, I have to watch. But I don't understand. How do they use the games, the chess games, to in the movies? Like they actually play out the same moves that chess played.
Well, it's a movie. A small spoiler. It's a movie about a female chess player who actually. Okay, it's from her childhood, so she becomes. She's crazy about chess, so she improves. So it's her kind of life story. And they're showing her playing tournaments from time to time, and then she's playing games, with top players. And then Garry Kasparov was a chess consultant there, and then he wants to make it more, realistic. He's setting up the positions, the real positions from real chess games, which were played in the past. It's all in all, I was not so. I mean, I didn't find it like an absolute masterpiece, but it's definitely a good one.
It's catchy. It's catchy. Yeah.
Yeah, it's very catchy. Definitely. Very catchy.
But I guess it's, it has absolute such a success. I don't know. I mean, just amazing. Absolutely amazing. It's everybody's totally crazy about it. And, for instance, there is some statistics that after that serial, last couple of months, numbers of chess boards sold all over the world increased like 200 times or something. I mean, everybody starts to play chess, to study chess, to buy chess boards and so on. So it's a huge success. Recommend it,
It's all right. Cool. I mean, so many people approached me like in terms of where and how to study. I mean, in like the chess fans in Azerbaijan as well. And like, I don't know, it sparked the huge interest somehow, which is very good for the game. So I'm not saying we're going to be as popular as tennis, but
but do you have something quite I guess Match Point, but it's not really about tennis, but movie which is it's not really about tennis, but do you have some very kind of successful movie where a tennis player is the main character?
There was two, right? I think there's Borg versus McEnroe, and then the one about Billie Jean King.
Yes, that's the one I think was the biggest. Mm-hmm. Yeah, but it was not. I mean, never hit this kind of attention from the people,
Mm-hmm. Well, yeah. And I think There's also a kind of a what was it, a parody or a spoof, or I forget what the name for it, a mockumentary, 7 Days in Hell, I think, or something like that. That was an interesting one, but I think it was an HBO movie. I bet it'd be pretty tough to find it online, but it was kind of a more like a, you know, kind of like Blades of Glory with Will Ferrell, or like a Dodgeball, that type of a movie. So it was a bit of a stupid thing, but it had some fun scenes. I think they based one of the characters on Andre Agassi, and then the other one, I don't know, I guess it was maybe like Roger Federer or something like that. So I've seen it by an accident, and it was pretty funny, some of the scenes. I think Johnny McEnroe was in it, Chris Evert, Serena Williams. I mean, they were doing like kind of these interview pieces, but I mean, it's kind of fun. It definitely, I'm sure it wasn't like Queen of Gambit, but it was just kind of a like fun and stupid movie.
And by the way, a question to both of you then, talking about documentaries, I'm sure there are some very interesting documentaries about tennis. So what would you recommend to all of us, I mean, who is listening to this conversation, and to us with Deymour personally, what would be your choice, I mean, to watch? I mean, some documentary about tennis players, or...
I don't know, Dmitry. I don't know. I don't know any. I don't think there are any like crazy good ones or good ones that I would really recommend. Or am I missing something?
I know there were a few, but typically they make them about the top players, and you know, obviously about Roger, Rafa, and I think there's actually a very good documentary about sports that I liked. I can't remember off the top of my head, but I think it was also Netflix, and it was more about the people, like not the winners but the losers, sort of thing. I have to look it up, but you know, if you give me a few seconds after I finish talking. But it was pretty interesting because it talked about you know, kind of the things behind the scenes, and I always thought it would have been fantastic to have a documentary about you know, lower stages of tennis, the futures. That's kind of where you have the crazies. Oof, and
you see everything.
Yeah, that's the chess as well, I must tell you.
Yeah,
chess as well. I mean, there are so many examples that if you once you know, you write some book about it, or make some documentary, yeah, I mean, it will certainly spark a lot of controversies, especially as Ivan, you said that there is this kind of stuff also in tennis and many other sports as well, I guess, with all these harsh coaches and you know, harsh parents and so on. So yeah, this is a kind of thing that probably we're trying in both chess and tennis and so on. We're trying to show the best part, certainly, of it. But there is a hard part.
But you know, at the highest possible level, things look professional because they have to be. You know, it's just normal. But then the lower the level is, the more chaos you see, and then the more, you know, unusual things you experience. This is, I think, is the same in every possible level, or sports, or game, or you name it. It's just how that's how it is.
Ivan, I don't know. Dmitry, I don't know if it sounds normal, I mean, to ask this. Certainly, if it's not possible to answer this, please don't, and tell me that it's not. Just asking, let's say you are coaching, I mean, let's be fair, one of the greatest players in the world. And Vladimir, is one of the greatest champions in the chess history. And I was also for a long time on top, but didn't become the world champion as yet. Well, still have this hope.
Still, you are aren't you around still? Top 10, yeah?
Hopefully, yeah, I'm in top 10, but I mean, hopefully if Vladimir once decides to help me, to coach me, and I still have some chance, I hope, but certainly we'll need a lot of motivational part from his side and my side as well, to reach any kind of tops. It's so hard, but there are like super great players, and as you said, you don't want to distract them during the game and so on. The game has finished. You have all the videos. You have everything, like all the informations. You have all the moments that were there. And can you say it like, for example, just one of examples is my dad is my like coach. And also I'm working with Vladimir Chuchilov, who's a chess coach, like the famous chess coach and so on. When I'm out of the playing hall, both of them can tell me like, you know, this kind of direct language that they can use. Like, is it possible also to use this kind of language when you are talking to the greats of tennis? Is it the same like in chess? Because in chess, clearly you come out and even yourself and the coaches, I don't know how in Vladimir's case, but were you okay with this comments? Like if somebody says, yo, how could you play this? What a stupidity it was and stuff like that. Even though you are a great champion and they tell you that it was a stupid move or something, what would you feel about it?
I mean, it didn't happen very often because usually it was the first sentence which I've said myself that, you know, I played like a total idiot, you know, this is just a shame to play like this. And then they would just follow it. Yeah, so it was the first one, but yeah, I see what you mean. Yeah,
they would support you with that.
Yeah, they would fully support me. Yeah.
Yeah, but the difference, I think the main difference is that in chess, you can lose the game by one move, you know, and this is, it happens actually quite often that one move actually, you know, can make a difference. In tennis,
that's true.
One move cannot really make a difference, or, you know, sometimes it's memorable that everybody talks about, but if a player misses the easy smash, usually it's not the reason why you lose the match, right? Yeah. So it is a bit different. You never really, at least not in my case, you know, that the player comes out and you tell him, well, why did you do that in that particular moment? Because it's actually much bigger picture when you analyze the match. It's the momentums, then their strategies and, you know, the tactics, and then, you know, playing deeper, playing shorter, attack, defend, you know. So it's more general talk than talking about one particular shot or point.
No, sorry, Ivan. We are also in chess. You know, it sometimes more relates to the situation when you just had a bad day. Yeah, it's not like, in fact, if you just made the one bad blunder, okay, nobody tells you, okay, this is just, you know, how could you do it? I mean, because everybody knows it can happen. Yeah, but sometimes you really have a bad game. It's like you made many mistakes. You really played below your level. So. That's what I guess Timur meant. Yeah, so yeah. I guess in tennis it's the same story. So what happens
like
in this
chain of
in this situation when it was really a bad performance this day? I mean, all, you know, in general.
And you did this, let's say, on this break point. How could you do this? Like a lot of stuff like that. Is it possible?
It can happen. You speak to the player and tell him, listen, you know, you're not going to have a lot of break points because you play the guy who's serving well. But if you get it, and if you get second serve, you have to attack, you know, and then, you know, you get one break point, 1 second serve, and you don't attack. And then, of course, you're like, what are you doing? You know, like, what's happening? You know, so again, it can happen, but rarely it's the case, you know, that you're going to analyze one single moment or the point in one match.
Yeah. But they take it okay. Yeah. Like the top players.
I mean, you know, everybody is feeling not fantastic when they lose the match, you know. But
certainly,
the thing is that it doesn't matter if he's a top or not top. He's a tennis player, you know. So he and any player has a coach for the reasons, and that coach is going to tell him what he thinks about the match. I mean, doesn't matter what level you play.
Yeah,
I mean,
but you know, there are some like greats of sports, and that they say, I mean, whatever I did was right somehow, like this. I mean, they have this kind of thinking. And they have this kind of perception that, okay, I know my mistakes. And there is, like, for example, in chess, I know my mistakes. There is an engine. It will show to me everything. Don't say any bad things. I feel like, I don't know, just cheer me up. And I mean, let's go for the dinner, for a walk or something. So I just thought, like, I mean, maybe to some, I mean, it depends on the character of the person as well, I guess. I mean, the character traits. And certainly, let's say, I mean, if some greats would tell you, I mean, let's say, for example, as far as I remember, I mean, maybe people, I mean, in the chat or I don't know, in the fans will correct me. Let's say Carlsen, he doesn't like in general to be like kind of coached this way. Yeah, that this is not right and this is this. He says that, okay, I more or less I understand myself, it's fine. And I think that there was also a story when he played against you, Vladimir, in the Vykanze, when I read it, I think, in New In Chess or something, that Kasparov was coaching him at the time or something
that. I actually broke the collaboration as far as I know. I mean, I learned it only a few years after.
Yes,
because of the game after which they stopped the collaboration.
Because he called him and he said that okay, maybe you play d4 and in d4 there is this line or something like this, and he wanted or maybe he wanted to play d4, and in fact Gary told him that maybe you have to play e4, there is this possibility in this line and so on. And then he said that he came to the game, he was like thinking 2 or 3 minutes just trying to concentrate. Yeah. He forgot which first move he wants to make. So it's exactly the case. That was it. And yes, they broke the collaboration because of this, because it's, I mean, exactly, Gary Kasparov is one of the...
I remember I went to a game, we were both in kind of good position, in the more or less leading position. Then usually, you know, the clocks are pressed, the arbiter presses the clock, and you quickly make your first move because it's prepared. Yeah. And then all of a sudden I see Magnus just sitting, he closed his eyes, and you know, he just sits there with a closed eyes, like for 2 or 3 minutes before making his first move. Well, I thought, okay, maybe he just a bit strange, but maybe he needs a special concentration, whatever can be. But then on the first move, finally he played d4. It was a very interesting game. I mean, very sharp and quite a good performance from my side. I managed to beat him at that game. And then the whole story appeared actually 2 or 3 years after publicly, that he said that was the moment, because he wanted to play one move. Then just before the game, Gariev called him and said, no, better play another first move because I have some idea. He was confused. Then he didn't like it. He lost the game. And actually, after that, they stopped the collaboration. I didn't know that.
I mean, yes, you know them better, but Gary and Magnus are not really compatible. Actually.
I don't know. I mean, okay, it's, I think Magnus, I mean, it was very useful for him, yeah?
Because no, for sure, you know, at the young age, but I'm talking about like now, right? I mean, we know Gary's character, and Magnus, it's quite similar. They're very competitive. Yeah. They never, you know, so I think Magnus got for sure a lot from him, but I just don't think that, you know, it is not, I don't know, I can see the clash, let's put it this way.
Yeah, I see what you mean, but you know, nothing is rests for forever. Yeah, so at least since they worked maybe for 1 or 1.5 years, and maybe it was very, very important for Magnus, chess wise. But that's clear that, even if not this particular game or case, it could have probably been some other one pretty soon, because there is a certain strong characters. But and for Dmitry, I have a question, because you can do it also during a match, yeah? And sometimes, as I've mentioned already, things are not so smooth, yeah? When you're trying to change the course of a game. And actually, I remember one video, which was actually, I mean, it was very impressive, because it was like 1-1 and player, I think it was Sabalenka. Yeah, she lost quite badly the second set, and then you have quite a kind of tense conversation with her, and then she beats 6-1 the third set. You know, like you managed to get in, even if she didn't seem to be extremely happy about it during at that moment. But what I wanted to ask you after the match. I mean, does it stay? Yeah, even if there is a certain, you know, tension in because during the match, okay, you have to do everything as a coach to make your play better, and sometimes this kind of shock therapy is needed. Yeah, that's true. But after the match, is it kind of getting smooth, and you know, it's like a part of the game? Yeah, like in football, sometimes they shout at each other, but after the match they say, okay, emotions are out, we are, everything is fine. So if this question is fine with you, if you want and can answer it.
I mean, it's a tough question to answer, because honestly, I believe that, you know, initially your conversation sort of started about, you know, what are the great players, how do they respond to coaches, you know, how do they respond to, you know, the tough love, or, you know, the coaching, you know, where there is no filter of how you deliver the information. And I believe that, and I could be wrong. I mean, I think Ivan would be probably a much better person to ask because he's been working with you know, one of the greatest players of all time, if not the greatest. I mean, we can argue about that until cows come home, but he's a very good player, obviously. So, but I think that the top players are more, they're tougher on themselves and they allow other people to be tougher. I mean, I cannot imagine that Rafa is just going to get upset at Uncle Tony for Uncle Tony telling him, like, you know what, Rafa, you really just, you know, you were inadequate today, you know, in some swear words in Spanish. I think that both people understand that, you know, the reason why the coach is giving him, you know, this kind of grief is to get the point across and to help him. So they're not doing it to personally insult them. And it's kind of weird for me to listen to this story about Kasparov and Magnus, because it sounds like the battle of the egos a little bit. And it feels like it's a bit of a blame game to where, you know, he loses the game because in the end, he makes a decision on which piece to move first. But as he lost this game, you know, it almost sounds like he's blaming Kasparov for losing that game.
No, but sorry to interrupt you for a second. Maybe it was accumulation. Yeah, maybe it was like a last drop of certain tensions, yeah, which was there. So I'm not sure it was really the only and, you know, the very big case, maybe an accumulation. But sorry, yeah, go on, please.
Yeah, I think people have to understand that as well, you know, a lot of times it's very rarely the coach is really just personally insulting the player. And I think that, you know, the top players are there at the top because they allow other people to criticize them. They take that criticism. They allow themselves to question, you know, whether they're doing everything correct or not. And they do not take this as a personal offense, because that's the only way to grow is to constantly push yourself and push your envelope. And if you don't do that, if you look for someone who's just going to take you out to dinner and kind of cheer you up, then you don't really need a coach. You don't need someone to criticize. You just need a cheerleader.
A lot of players actually travel with friends instead of coaches. Yeah.
Okay. Let's call them friends. Yeah.
Well, you know, the friends, but I would put it into parentheses, you know, the friends, because, you know, a lot of times it becomes, it happens where the friends or the, you know, the people that are the mean well or try to help, they actually kind of get in the way of that progress, because the progress cannot be comfortable. And we tend to, you know, as creatures, we tend to go into the comfortable mode very quickly. And I think Floyd Mayweather said that, you know, it's tough to get up and run at 6 a.m. when you're sleeping in silk pajamas. So the idea is that when you get too comfortable, you know, your opponents tend to pass you. And so you always have to look for people who, don't criticize you just for anything, but that are being honest with you. And I think it's like that, not only in sports, but in life as well. You know, if you're always getting compliments, there's something wrong, you know, because we as humans, we always make mistakes. And, you know, and in sport, especially, it's very easy to lose your advantage. So you always have to improve. And it's amazing, you know, Roger, I always use actually Martina Navratilova as an example, because when you watch her play, you know, in 70s, I mean, she's like literally pushing the ball over the net. And then all of a sudden now she's playing in 90s or 2000s. And the game has changed so much, but she's still staying relevant. You know, her game changes as well. So the only way you can do that is by pushing yourself, but also allowing other people to push you when you cannot push yourself. And I think it's very important. And I'm sure that Ivan is not, you know, he's not filtering his words as much as we think. You know, like, I'm sure he's, you know, he's quite direct. And, you know, it's just, the thing is, Roger's probably not gonna come off the court saying like, oh my god, did you see I lost this match because, you know, this one bad call. Like, he understands that, you know, he takes responsibility for his actions, and it's much easier to work with an athlete when the athlete is actually asking you for input and asking you for constructive criticism. Whichever language it is. I mean, you know, if someone talks to me and swears at me, I understand that, you know, as long as it's not a personal insult, I understand that it's all about, you know, work and getting better. But yeah, with girls, it's a little different. And, you know, we've had our fair share of fights. And you know, regarding that match, I believe it was against Svitolina. I had some kind of tough words, I guess, to say, though I didn't feel like it was tough at the time. I felt like at the moment, you know, she was just allowing, you know, her emotions, and just, you know, she didn't want to push herself. She just, you know, kind of acted a little bit unprofessional. And so I said whatever I felt at the time, and, you know, it seemed to click with her, but, you know, I can't say that, you know, this is the right recipe.
No, of course. No, it obviously worked, but the question is that after that, it was not a problem. Yeah.
No. Well, you know, maybe she's kind of kept it inside, in the back of her mind, and just, you know, she's like, oh, always, you know, went to sleep every day since then. And she's like, oh my God, you know, he never apologized for things to me.
No, but I actually don't find it anything. I mean, there was nothing insulting or bad. It was just kind of emotional and tough, but of course it was obviously not personal or insulting. I mean, it's just that, but I guess some players might not like, this.
Yeah, but you know, it's mm-hmm. I guess in chess it's like, it's the same. It's always this dynamic between the player and the coach, where the player pays the coach to then be told what to do, you know. So it's always tricky, where is the line? Because if you go over the line, you might lose your job, if, you know, but you have to push, because if you don't push, you don't get the results, which then you're gonna lose your job. So it is a fine line, you know. And then, but it always is gonna be individual, you know, because some players, you know, needs to be pushed and wants to be pushed. Some players like to have, you know, civilized conversation 2 days after the match. Some of them like to have it right away. It's very individual. I don't think there is one rule that suits everybody.
And I guess also depends very much on the situation. Because usually, yeah, my trainers, you know, I've played 4 World Championship matches on among other events. And I remember once we had quite a tough conversation, actually, with one of my trainers, with whom we never had one, but I remember it was really going bad. It was my match against Topalov, and I was leading first, and some things were happening. Finally, I lost another game, and I was already down to the on the score, and it was a really bad game, and I knew it. It was, I don't know what happened to me. It was really awful. And then, he was kind of asking, which is okay, but he was, he was insisting that, okay, just cannot understand why, how can I play this move or that move? And I got a bit angry, I mean, for a moment, because I was also, I mean, I said, come on, I also don't understand. I mean, just, you know, but actually it worked. And he said to me, you know, it just was, I felt like I need to shock you, I need to do something that you are out of this kind of, you know, strange mode. Yeah. And it
not
helped.
Thinking,
I mean,
about chess.
I won the next game and won the match finally. So sometimes it helps. So if it's done with a good purpose, with a cleverly and with the right concept, yeah, that you want really, that sometimes a player, any player, tennis or chess player, he needs to be shocked a bit at some point, just to, you know, to make certain change.
Absolutely.
Okay, so an easy question. Thank you so much for the cool answers for like any question. It's like really, it's like reading a book, you know, like you're explaining everything A to Z. So it's so nice of you. Thank you so much. And the question, easy question, goes to Kramnik, because it's easy for tennis professionals. Do you know how many titles Federer, Nadal, and Djokovic have now Grand Slam titles for today?
I know that there are fights. Yeah, like 2019, or something. I think that Nadal 20 has 20. For Nadal, he has one more. No, I think he has one extra, if I'm not mistaken.
You know, for me, as a Roger Federer's fan, for
me,
it would be much easier to say that Roger has 20 titles, which is the thing. And I didn't know that Nadal has 20 titles as well, and he has 20 titles now.
Ah, it's and, equal now, yeah, it's 20.
Yeah. And 17 for Djokovic, is it right?
Yeah, I mean, something like that.
Yeah, Ivan and Dmitry,
is it
right?
Yes.
And is there any way to describe the, now question goes to you, and I mean, all of the three of you, I mean, is it possible to describe the best chess, I mean, best chess players we can describe, let's say, with Vladimir? We are trying to, it's hard to describe the best world champion ever and so on. but we have some kind of points where we can find the, you know, the kind of common opinion, more or less, that this like two or three chess players, like the world champions, are greatest in ever. For now, is it depending on the Grand Slam titles, or is there any other criteria? Certainly, you as a coach of Roger is, I mean, you have a biased opinion, certainly. But at the same time, we're like with Vladimir, we're like kind of, can we say we're fans? Or are we plastic fans if we miss some matches?
No, I mean, we are fans. I actually liked this kind of classical players very much, tennis players and chess players as well. So I was... Yeah, I liked very much how Sampras was playing. To my understanding of tennis, it was very classical. Yeah, like a very complete universal player. And once Roger appeared, very quickly became my favorite player because it was, I mean, it's also like an art as well. I don't know. It's strange. I don't know how to say it. But when you look at his play, the way he moves, and it seems that it's not completely, of course, effortless, but that like it's much less effort seemingly into his match. And also his left back, I mean, backhand, I like this for some reason, one-handed, you know, backhand players. I mean, I like it's aesthetic, you know, when the one hand goes.
I was able to pull it from time to time in my tennis.
No, I always played one-handed backhand. I mean, when I and of course his longevity and in general, I am definitely a Federer fan. Although of course I appreciate other players as well, and that's very interesting. I thought it was 1920. If it's 2020, I mean, it doesn't actually matter. Yeah. Doesn't matter because they're so great each. I mean, who cares who will have one or two more at the end of the
career? No. I just mean that if you would pick up one, and the other thing is that, I mean, it's like for us, the tennis fans, and the other thing is like for professionals, how they consider it, because many times we're asked who is the greatest player ever, like when they're asking us about chess. Yeah. So for us, let's say, who would be your pick? Three players, Federer, Nadal, and Djokovic.
You mean for chess player or for the tennis players?
No, as a tennis player. They're not chess players, as far as I know. Yeah, so for tennis players, who is your
pick? Or anyone else, maybe, I don't know.
Well, by the titles, nobody comes even close, yeah? I mean, like...
Yeah, but the problem is that, you know, back in the days, the Grand Slam titles were not the only measuring stick, you know? So it is very difficult to compare generations. I mean, these three absolutely are... You know, they have to be up there, you know, together with others, because also what Sampras did at his time, because he was also running against the history by himself, basically, at the time. You know, now these three guys, they push each other. We can almost discuss how it's easier now, because they do kind of, you know, ask questions. But Sampras was doing something that he was never done before. You know, he finished the year number one for 6 years in a row, you know, won 14 slams when nobody else won anywhere near. So, you know, and then we have, you know, if we go way back with Rod Laver and you know, we have many legends, and it's difficult to point finger as, okay,
Lendl
who is
as well,
the greatest?
Ivan Lendl maybe as well?
Yes, I think, you know, yes, great player. Again, you know, fantastic results and a lot of titles, slams, number ones, this and that. I don't think, you know, now everybody talks about these Grand Slam titles, which is, of course, they are the biggest tournaments in the world. And you know, it is the most important kind of information, but cannot be the only one, you know. But what I think is that generally the Federer fans and not only, you know, only his fans, but what you described earlier is... It's not only how many, but how you win them, you know? So I think the Roger, what he brought to the game is definitely this level of elegance and how he goes about tennis in general and how he goes with the people. And he just, it's very easy to like him, you know? There's nothing not to like, you know? Unless you are like Djokovic or Nadal, hardcore fan, that you just don't want him to win more than others, it's just, you know, very easy to like him. So... I wouldn't know, but you know, then is it the greatest is always the one that won the most? This is also greatest and the most successful. And then I also think that we could almost make two different conversations here. You know,
because you don't have the world championship title.
We don't.
But even if you do, there are still always in the history of any game and tennis as well. There is quite a number of players who are really great. Yeah. I mean, some more, some less, and then it gets, you know, then many things are, I guess, getting into it, like your personality, you know, time. I mean, maybe you like more some player who was playing tennis when you were 20 than when you are 60, if you're getting to this age. So a lot of...
maybe to answer that question, in any sport, I would rather look in to say, okay, did any sportsman change his sport? You know, and that's where when I talk about, you know, maybe Michael Jordan, we talk about Muhammad Ali, we talk about, you know, like the people that actually changed the sport as such, you know, or Tiger Woods, or, you know, like somebody who actually really brought the sport to another level. And here we have to talk about Bjorn Borg, you know, even though he retired super soon, but he was the first maybe global superstar of tennis. We have to include him as a greatest or one of the greats without maybe being the most successful one. Mm-hmm. And I think I would put here both Roger and Rafa, you know, definitely in the conversation. Yeah. Novak as well in his, you know, the way he does. But these people did change the sport. And on the female side, we definitely have to talk about, you know, again, even there we have... We cannot, even though it looks like it's clearer, but it's not.
Williams is no.
Yeah, definitely. Yeah.
Yeah, but you know, somebody would say Steffi Graf. Somebody would say Martina.
Somebody would say it's another story, Ivan. Somebody would say it's another story because I mean, many of my fans consider me the best player ever in chess. So I mean, so that doesn't make me the best player ever in chess.
No, but I don't. I personally don't think it's a clear cut, even on the female side. I don't know, Dmitry, what do you think?
Okay, now both diplomatically correct and like politically correct people answered the question, and now we're waiting for the answer. And
yeah, so Dmitry, what is your
there
pick?
There is no gong or something. What is it?
What is your pick in male and female? I mean, tennis.
Well,
or a few. I mean, let's say 2-3 if you want.
You're all keeping it PC, and then you're like, okay, well, let's give it to this guy. This guy's always gonna his mind, you know, and then he's gonna get in trouble.
No.
Nobody's watching. But you had something.
But okay, it's another story. Yeah. Okay. Yeah. Sorry.
Mm-hmm. I'm sure I'm on mute anyways. So I'll just talk. I think, you know, what I think Ivan is actually trying to get at it, or part of it is what is the definition of the greatest tennis player? Like, right? Because some people define it by, you know, the winning, the most amount of Grand Slam titles. If we were considering greatest of all time by winning the total amount of tournaments, then maybe somebody else would have won. And I'm sure that at the time when Laver was playing, you know, he probably wasn't thinking like, oh my God, you know, I want to be the greatest, so I got to win as many slams as I can. He was just, you know, probably playing, trying to win as much as he could. But then at some point, and I don't know, maybe before Sampras, there was this kind of who's the greatest of all time. But I think when Sampras won 17, that became kind of the measuring stick, at least for me. You know, I wasn't around tennis, before Sampras was playing. So maybe when Lendl was playing, they were already talking about who's the greatest player of all time. But it seems like it's quite the recent kind of a conversation or debate. And that's why you can't really pick one, because, you know, you could say, well, Rafa's winning 20 titles, but he's not playing as many on clay, which is his favorite surface. But if there was more clay or more slams on slower surfaces, then he would have won more slams. But they are definitely pushing themselves. So they're actually competing against probably the toughest competition, you know, during their time. I don't know what was happening in 40s or 50s, you know, when Laver was playing, 60s and 70s. Again, you know, you got to make a clear definition of how do you judge who's the greatest based on merits, you know, based on his best based backhand or who has the best forehand. But what I would agree with Ivan is that, you know, who makes the impact on the game. And I think Roger just made tennis so popular. It hasn't been this popular, I think, since Borg McEnroe, when, you know, when the whole Europe was just losing their mind over tennis. I mean, it's hard for tennis to stay relevant against other sports. But they were they managed to do that. And I don't think Novak or Rafa are, you know, come close to the global awareness of tennis. You know, if you tell anybody who doesn't know tennis, the word tennis, they think of Roger Federer. You know, and then if they know a little bit about tennis, they can think of Roger, Rafa, Murray, Novak. So in that sense, I believe, like, out of the three, Roger's obviously, you know, the greatest, because he made the game bigger than it was before him. He definitely, from professional standpoint, I like his game. He's very biomechanically, you know, almost flawless. He's very elegant and effortless because of that. You know, but Rafa is just very physical, very disciplined. Novak's got, you know, incredible discipline with, you know, and just looking for any advantages he has. But yeah, I mean, the elegance and the effortless of Roger, you know, if I talk about biomechanics or technique with anybody, you know, I use him as an example, because, you know, he's got it, you know, he's got it down quite well, to almost like perfection, to where, you know, you really, I don't even know, honestly, I ask myself this question all the time. Like, you know, if I was Ivan, like, what would I tell him? Like, I wouldn't know what to tell him. Like, the guy probably knows more than all of us combined. So, you know, I would think it's so hard to coach someone who just, you know, who's that good. Yeah, I mean, I would go with Roger based on that, just based on a number of the slams, but I don't believe that, you know, it's correct to base this argument just based on the number of slams.
Yeah.
Is it possible now to show the proof that Vladimir Kramnik loves tennis? Is it least possible to put it on
the proof? One, yeah, photo.
Yeah, there is a proof. Yeah, so can we see it there?
It's 2000. Yeah, it's
that backhand looks smooth, I have to say.
It's not too bad. Yeah, I mean
the right leg is like in front, all as it should be. Yeah.
But and actually it was a real game. I mean, I just was training, and, you know, somebody was making a photo, so it's not like, it's not a montage, you know, that I could play a bit of tennis at some point. Yeah, it was actually 2000, yeah, just before my match against Garry Kasparov.
But what was your, I mean, was it a part of the physical program? Did you do something else, like a lot of stuff?
Or? I was swimming also, swimming and tennis. Yeah, I liked it. And okay, but actually I never cared about result. And it was more like, you know, my goal was to play for 1.5 hour in a row, and just to run non-stop practically, and just to make it as a physical exercise. But, you know, when you have to work on your physical shape as a chess player as well, but it's better than to do something you enjoy, because you can, I mean, you know, swimming I never enjoyed. Yeah, it's so extremely boring. Good, because I always had some back issues, and then it was supposed to be the best thing I can do. And I can swim well. I was born on the sea, so, but it was terribly boring always for me, you know, because I used to swim for 1 hour in a row and so on, 1.5, and okay, it's really boring. But tennis was actually not the best for my type of, you know, physiology and for my back, but that at least I enjoyed. Yes, so I was trying to mix. I remember during this last session, we had in Spain, actually in Mallorca, and I would play for 1.5 hour. Tennis, and then going to swim for another half an hour or something, yeah, and then would come back to chess in the afternoon, something like that. Yeah.
How many hours of chess would you do then, let's say, in these preparations? Is it,
you know, I mean, the big difference with chess and tennis, that in tennis you cannot really prepare or work or whatever, yeah, when you don't have a racket with you, you know, at some point you just leave a tennis court. Okay, you can still think a bit about it, but basically you are free. Yeah, in chess you have a chess board in your head. Yeah, so that's why it's very difficult to, you know, to count exactly the hours. So basically there is I remember before this World Championship match, we would start working at 3 and up till 8, 9 I mean, this kind of serious phase, yeah, when you are on the chessboard with computers, you analyze. But of course, in the morning, you think a bit about it and you check something with the computer, and maybe late at night, you cannot fall asleep because you got some idea and you think about it, you try to analyze. So, but it's,
sorry, Vladimir, but when did you start including computers in your preparations and work?
I would say 95, 96, maybe when the chess programs, chess engines became quite already considerably strong, because I was already top 10 player. My first Linares top chess tournament, which is like Wimbledon, you know, in tennis, was in 1993. I was 17. I didn't have a computer yet. I actually came there with some notebooks, you know, with a couple of books with me. So there was no computer yet. But starting from the middle of 90s, and then I would say close to 2000, where I already, you know, was fighting for the world championship and became world champion. Of course, we were using intensively already the computer. It became a very important part of our preparation.
Always wanted to ask you about this Berlin. How did it come to mind? I mean, because Karchinov was showing it to me when I was a kid, and he would say that that's kind of strange, but he would say that it's the opening of the future, and it was 1998 or something.
Yeah.
And he showed me this line, and I was like, oh, I mean, it's just like, seems like wars for black. I mean, how can it be, like, with King in the center, like running there and there, it seemed to be at the time. And then when you played the match, I just remembered these words, yeah, because it was like in a few years, more or less. So it wasn't him, yeah, it was just one of you that came across the idea.
Viktor was very competitive, you know. I think in 98, he was already close to 70. Yeah, he was close to 70, yeah, but he was still playing pretty well. No, I remember I played...
He was 2700 rated player, yeah.
Yeah, yeah, I remember I played 70 years, his birthday tournament, which was organized in Zurich. It was in 2001. So he was already 60, he was already 67, but still playing on kind of top 50 level. And just, it was not from him, because he wouldn't share such secret with his concurrents. He was very competitive, you know. And
you think that he still thought that he was taking you as a...
Of course. No, I mean, we played the same tournaments, and we had quite many funny stories. I remember exactly 98, I think, or 99, I had some fun. Well, everybody used to, yeah, with Viktor. You know him very well.
Sure.
So I had a funny story, because actually it's also connected with the Berlin defense, because I guess it was exactly the time when he started it. He understood maybe also as me 1 or 2 years later that it was quite interesting and more prospector than people think.
Yeah.
And but he has played, it was a tournament in Spain, I think 98 or 99, and he was not doing so well. Lost a couple of games. Okay, it was a very top tournament, actually, with many top players, I mean, best players in the world. And at this age, even just being able to compete there, it's already, I mean, amazing, yeah. But still, yeah, it was very, you know, it was doing not so well. And I remember I've played a game with him sometime in the middle of the tournament. And I always had a very good score against him. I mean, because, first of all, okay, it was at my prime, more or less. He was already, of course, much after, yeah, his prime, and also he was very aggressive player. So I knew, kind of, you know, when you play with him, you just have to play solid. He never really tries to play for a draw. He's taking a lot of risks, and since I'm younger, I calculate variations better. So I knew, you know, whatever color you are, white or black, you just play solid and you wait for him to start attacking. And then quite at times those attacks were a bit unprepared. Then you just make use of it, and I won quite a few games against him. So we are playing with him, I think, fifth round, and he lost his, like, two losses, two draws or something like this. So I'm somewhere in the much better situation. So I play black against him, and he comes to a game. He plays some opening, very solid opening. So, okay, doesn't matter. He's going to push at some point, yeah? And... okay, then he changes all pieces. You know, I don't understand what's going on. It's absolutely not his style, yeah? And okay, when everything is kind of changed, he offers a draw. Okay, it's not Viktor, you know, Timur. I mean, he always fights.
Always fought.
Okay, but there is nothing to play for anymore. I mean, if I would, okay, I wanted to win this game, but I was not expecting it at all that he would do this. So, but there is nothing to play for already. You cannot really win. So I agree to a draw. And the game, like, takes 20 minutes, actually. okay, I'm totally puzzled. So it's very strange, but okay, it's his choice, he's right. And then he starts to tell me, you know, young man, you know, I never do things like this, you know, just to play for a draw with white, you know, and so on. So yeah, I know Viktorovich, of course, yeah. Said, but you know why I did it? Because I lost yesterday a game against Michael Adams. And actually it was Berlin defense. He lost a game in Berlin defense. He played Berlin defense and lost it. So yeah, of course I saw it actually, yeah. And said, yeah, you know, and he started to be very kind of, I think it was so, you know, it affected him so much. You know, can you imagine at this age to be so competitive? Said, you know, and Michael Adams was a very top player. He was number 5 in the world, so very, very strong player. Said, you know, I always lose to Michael Adams. Yeah. And well, and he's more like talking to himself even. Yeah, not really even. I mean, he's telling it to me, but more like, so, but I know. I also lost. I always lose against you as well. Yeah, I know. But, and then it was a fantastic sentence he said. You know, I mean, he didn't even think so much of what he said. So, but, you know, I also lost against you sometimes, but you at least you're playing active chess. at least you're playing active chess. But Mickey, you know, but Mickey Adams, he's just moving around. You know, I don't understand. He doesn't even attack me. So how can I lose again?
And at the time he was exactly doing this, yeah, to all of the opponents more or less.
Yeah, and actually I was only like number 3 in the world. Well, you know, at least. Yeah. It was very funny. Yeah.
He was quite, but we have that in tennis very similar. You know, some players just sit and wait, you know, and
of course
it's painful sometimes.
I guess even Lendl was one of the main at least
David Ferrer, no, was he like that?
No, but I mean, no? It's like, it's more aggressive. I mean I don't know what meter it takes, but I think like Gilles Simon is one of those that is just, it's a French player, you know, he was top 10 also,
but
he would just push the ball around and just make it long. His tactic was make the match long as possible, you know. So he was light and he was like, you know, he could go for hours. So he would just try to stretch it as much as possible.
But your style was always aggressive, like Yugoslavian chess school. Yeah, it's like, because I've seen this, the Najdorf is your favorite opening as black, is it?
Oh, well, I mean, the Najdorf. This is a story about Najdorf because of MVL. But, you know, I never really studied, you know, openings or because now we can talk about that if you want. But for me, when I wrote to Maxim, when I saw that he was going to do this simultaneous exhibition, you know, I signed in, you know, and then I wrote him on Twitter just hoping that, you know, I said, listen, by the way, I signed in. I hope I'm gonna get picked, you know. And then he actually replied me, said, no, I'll play with you even if you're not picked, you know, I'll add couple slots. So that was maybe 10 days before the actual game or a week. You know, and then I started to panic. I was like, I just hope I'm not going to get embarrassed, you know. So then I actually spoke to Antonio and our friend Agat Mater. I said, so what should I do? Like, how do I, you know, get ready for this? If there is anything I can do, you know, he said, no, you know, but he's, you know, his favorite opening. I said, I know he's a Najdorf specialist, but what, I'm going to play Najdorf against him? Are you crazy? He said, no, well, why not? I said, okay, let me try. Right. So like for a week, I studied Najdorf, you know, I just kind of went deep and tried to, you know, look at potential lines and you know, but I, for one second, I did not think that he's not going to play D4, you know? So for me, it was like, of course, he's going to give me a chance to play Najdorf. And then when actual simultaneous start, you know, I was like one of the last in the line. I saw he was playing everything, you know, I was like, oh my God, what if he... what if he goes for something else? Oh my God, I'm gonna be burned. And then he kind of, you know, played against my Najdorf, which I was like, at least relief. I know that for like 10-15 moves, I'm gonna be fine. That was my, you know, relief. And then the game continued, and of course that, you know, that game people started to talk about it. And because of that 1 week of Najdorf, I kind of know a bit more about that than anything else. But you know, it's I never really studied openings too much, and if I play with white, I play Gioco Piano, you know, so it's not really my style. It's the aggressive style. It's just that you know, I play a lot in those, and then I feel most comfortable in those. That's about it.
But against D4, what is it? What is the favorite opening?
I play Karo Khan. I mean, I don't
know. Against play... D4, against D4, against
D4, I play Naidoo, of course.
No, D4, Ivan. The first D4?
The closed opening.
As white? Yeah, the closed ones, like knight f3, c4, d4, whatever, without d4.
I don't know. I just push the pawns in the middle. I mean,
I'm telling you.
That's what I do. I know the basics.
That's what we do. I was actually playing Karo Khan last year because how I get to that, because I wanted to play something that is not really played lately. You know, so I started to go and look at the games in 1670s, and I saw, the Karo Khan was played, and I think it was Lasker or somebody was playing. And I was like, okay, let me try to go maybe into this a bit, you know. So that's how but for me, I don't like when somebody plays to me e4. I'm not, you know, it's like give me my Neidorf, give me something that I'm more comfortable with.
Yeah.
And by the way, sorry, gentlemen, because I have to leave. I've promised my kids to be free by 5:30, and it's already almost 6.
Okay,
but sure. I actually have another, just the last question, which is personally interesting. I mean, I'm very interested about it, and I guess maybe the public as well would be, which is what kind of, let's say, maybe players concretely, and in general, a style of play for both of you in tennis, you feel like you couldn't cope with, or which was extremely unpleasant for you, you know, that you couldn't really get adjusted to. I mean, because we also, as chess players, we have sometimes this kind of very annoying, very difficult opponents where for some reason you just cannot manage, or difficult, strange kind of style of play, which you cannot cannot get used to, and it's very interesting for me as a tennis player just to know if it exists also, and if you experienced something like that as well.
Dmitry, you go.
All right, so we all have Mike Adams in our lives. Actually, I think Marat Safin used to hate playing with Santoro. I mean, that guy just drove him off
the
wall. But like, he literally, he would lose the match before the match started. He didn't really like that. For me, I didn't like to play against Davidenko. But to be honest, I think like Andy Murray's is very tough to play. He's kind of like that. I feel like Mike Adams a little bit, right? Like, he just kind of moves the ball around. It's like always in the wrong spot. It's, you know, changes in speeds, heights. I mean, he looks like he's miserable a lot of the times on the court, and it just kind of he drags you down. Like, it's just, I mean, he suffocates you with his game. He kind of creates this like spider web, and you just get caught in it.
Fabrice Santoro? Yeah.
Yeah, I remember he had a very strange technique.
He was not a tall guy. He was a small guy.
Yeah. Yeah, it was short, but holding the racket in a very strange way sometimes, I felt, but very,
yeah, he was a very, very unusual. And also, I remember there was Chang as well, yeah? Was it? What times were it, like, was Chang, when Chang was playing?
It was late 80s, early late 90s, 80s.
I remember still a few matches.
He played until something like end of 90s, no?
Yes, definitely.
Yeah, he did, okay. And
for you personally, Dmitry, what was, what style of which opponent, more or less of your level, I guess, of course, if you're talking, okay, Federer, Nadal, okay, for everyone, the difficult opponents, but maybe not necessarily because of the style, but because of the strengths. But we are talking more of a player of more or less your level who was very difficult not to crack.
I didn't really like Davidenko, but I mean, he was higher in terms of rankings. I mean, Murray was also higher than me in rankings, but even when they were a little bit lower, I just didn't like, for some reason I couldn't get past Davidenko. Although, like, I figured out at one point that he really didn't like these kind of like slow dead balls in the middle. Just kind of by accident, I kind of stumbled upon Yeah. So then again, you know, they're uncomfortable until you figure out a way how to play them. You know, once I figured out how to play David Ferrer, I beat him twice. And so I think that the discomfort comes from kind of inability to play against this player. I don't know. I heard the story about Roger Federer, how he figured out, you know, how to play against Leighton Hewitt, and he was just using his kind of type of a shot slice. It doesn't come up very high, and he would just force his, you know, Leighton Hewitt to come to the net, and then he would be able to pass him fairly easy. I think it really comes down to like figuring out, okay, why you're not able to play against this person, why he doesn't, you know, why you don't like to play against him. And then if you're able to improve your game to address those things, then all of a sudden this player becomes very comfortable to play against. You know, I played against Santor, and I could see how you could, you know, your mind just would go, you know, just explode. But then when I slowed down a little bit and stopped trying to hit, you know, winner off of every shot, it became much easier to play him. So yeah, I think it just, I never got a chance to figure out how to beat Andy. And, you know, give me 10 more years, I would have been like all over Rafa and Roger and Novak, but it stopped too early.
And you, Ivan, what?
No, but for me, I obviously with my game, you know, for me it was important that I can win quite a bit of points with my serve. You know, so the good returners generally would create me a lot of problems. I mean, actually, I mean, Dmitry kind of style of players would bother me a lot, because the ball will kind of keep coming back always at the same speed. So, you know, in my service games, the tactics was quite similar, quite simple. You know, I try to win the point with the serve or with shot later, you know, and if I get into the rally, I try to mix up as much as possible to get something to then attack and go to the net, you know. So on the return, you know, I generally didn't have a lot of problems with the guys with the bad second serve. So that's why maybe my success with Davidenko was a bit better. I figured out quite quickly, actually, that he didn't like the balls in the middle. So I had actually good success with him. But for me, like David Ferrer or Dmitry or like the guys who would play like medium to fast pace left and right, no matter what you do, you know, it was tiring for me. It was difficult to play, you know, and especially, I mean, Dmitry also had a good return. David Ferrer, these kind of players, you know, with Roger, I played 16 times and, you know, I won three, but it was always, I always enjoyed playing, even losing to him. It was always something was happening, you know. I wouldn't like to be suffocated, you know, and that you, whatever you do, it always the same. Always the same ball comes back, you know. This was difficult for me. If I felt like I can attack, it was good enough for me. I felt like, okay, it's on my racket. If I can do well, I'll win. So that was the comfort that I was looking for.
Okay, good. I'm sorry, gentlemen. I have to run.
Yes, thank you so much. Thank you so much, Vladimir.
You can continue if you want for hours. I will look at the end of your stream, because for me it was a big pleasure. Thank you very much, Ivan and Dmitry. Because yeah, I'm a big tennis fan and you know, doing some streams from time to time lately, but mainly about chess. And of course, talking about tennis is, at least for me, is 10 times more interesting, asking questions and to see such a big masters. So thank you very much, Timur, as well, for organizing it. And wish you all the very best, gentlemen.
Thank you so much.
Thank you very much. Thank you.
Thank you. Next week, we talk about swimming.
Yeah, possibly. Dmitry, what is your level in chess? Are you playing from time to time, or is it just the friendship with Kramnik that makes you talk about chess from time to time?
my level is I know how to move the chess pieces. I know where they're supposed to go. I play around, but I mean not to the point where I know the openings. Perhaps I'm actually playing some combinations, maybe some famous ones without knowing. You know, maybe I have a Berlin defense. I don't know. I don't even know what it looks like. So it's not very, it's definitely not very advanced. I mean, it's advanced to, you know, in comparison to people who don't know how to put, you know, how to move chess pieces. But I think I was actually quite surprised. I thought it was always, you know, about improvising, but from what I understand, there's actually, you know, some certain rules and certain kind of basic ideas of, you know, I have this app on my phone. So the you know, the kind of how you control the middle and stuff like that. So
yeah.
There are lessons there. You know, I when I play, I just free ball, you know, like I, you know, just kind of, you know, whatever comes to my mind. Like if I want to start with a pawn, you know, in front of the rook, then I start like that.
Okay. Yeah, that's not the best opening. That's not the best opening. But from time to time, it works. Yeah.
Yeah, but well, you know, if someone asked me why I did it, I'd be like, I have no clue. I just got bored with pushing the front piece, like the middle pieces. You know, so
yeah,
so
yeah,
I
went controlling the center.
My rook needs some space.
Some fresh air. Yeah.
Yeah. That sounds, you know, sounds almost like, yeah, my bishop or my rook, yeah, needs some space or some air. It sounded weird, very weird. But yeah, I have no clue what I'm doing, basically. That's my level. If there is that level, you know, it's, I have no clue, then there's like 1200, 1300 and so forth.
Yeah, yeah, I see. So Ivan is playing like from time to time, he said like around 2000, yeah, in a good day, yeah, with like the... like let's
go. I can no I like it. I mean, I don't know what's good, bad, it's very difficult, but yeah, I mean, I'm into it completely. I don't study, you know, but I play a lot, and I follow a lot games, and I, as I told you at the beginning, I love to listen and to others talking about chess and analyzing games. This I like.
Yeah, so I just wanted to show the chess fans and yeah, everybody who will watch the stream later on as well, your game against Maxim Vasilyagraf, quite fast, because I think Agat Mater, Antonio Radic, who is like, can we call him our mutual friend? Yeah, and the big person for chess, and especially for online chess, because he did a lot with his YouTube channel. I think he's the top. I think that he's the top. You know.
There's almost 900,000 subscribers.
Yeah, I think it's around 900,000 subscribers on YouTube, and he does a lot of interesting stuff. And whenever the game finishes, let's say I finished the game like 5 minutes ago against Wesley So, in about 15, there is already the game on his channel, and he's analyzing it already. Went through all of the lines. He's like so much, you know, putting so much effort to this. Like. I mean, really impressive, because I've just finished the game, like in 20 minutes, it's on the channel with a lot of comments already analyzed, a lot of tricks and everything. So he probably looks at it with the computer, with the engine, and really finds a lot of nice lines. So for the audience, just wanted to show that the way Ivan plays, I mean, he's very humble about his chess, but you know, both Vladimir and me, it never crossed our minds to go for the Knight as black against Vasilyagraf. Because it seemed like so unnatural. It's like, you know, it's like playing against, I don't know, against Federer's forehand or something, maybe.
You know, my thinking was I'm going to get hammered. I'm going to get destroyed. And let me at least have fun. And, you know, I wanted to see his reaction when he sees that somebody's playing Neidorf against him, you know.
Yeah. Okay,
but then I mean, I at some point later, obviously, after analyzing, I even had the chance to, like, go up, you know, with moving my pawn to attack his knight. And I was over the moon with just, you know, staying stable and not getting killed. So
so super fast. I'm going to show you guys the game by Ivan. He will explain maybe some of the decisions, what he did there, and I think we'll be we can call it a day afterwards, because all of these people are super busy with their tennis careers. I cannot say now, but with the coaching career more now, right?
Yeah,
but they have a lot of stuff to do, guys, and so I will just show you fast how strong Ivan is, even though he says that, you know, on a bad days he can play 1600, but I don't believe it. Both me and Vladimir, we were thinking if we have to play against you on the stream, but then we decided that you know, we will keep our image safe.
Thank you.
No. We will keep our image safe and pretend that we're top chess players.
So you know, if you guys want to get your confidence up, you can play against me. I mean, you know where I'm gonna go.
Anytime up, yeah. Up for it.
You know which I'm gonna have, you know, it's the pawn, the rook pawn.
Yes.
There was a great like US grandmaster who was the Fisher's coach, and he was playing it, Robert James Fisher. He was like the one of the greatest in chess, yeah. And he was playing against the coach, and he was always beating him like around like 10-0 or 10-1 or something when they were playing the training matches. And US Chess Federation and the representatives, they were asking Robert James, I mean, what is the point of you playing him? Maybe we can call like strong guys, like, I don't know, Ryshevsky and everyone else, like to fight against him and so on. He said, no. The point is that I actually like it because I feel like a tiger afterwards. And if I play an even match, I'm not sure about my condition, you know, like if I'm able to maintain this kind of strengths. So that's the case. And also, just one question to you, to both of you before I show the game. Fischer's reply on who is the best chess player in the world. He said once that he was not the world champion at the time, and Boris Spassky was the world champion. He was supposed to play a match against him. And he was asked by the journalist, and he said that, he was asked that Robert James, who is the best player in the world? He said, the best player in the world. So number one is me. Second and third, there is none. And the fourth is Spassky. And Spassky was the world champion at the time. Is there any tennis player like Fischer who is having this kind of strong opinions? Or it's more like in chess now? In chess now, it's like more about like kind of friendly up there on the top and so on. Not like, you know, the Soviet times and so on. No, is there any guy like this?
Friendly. It is very friendly now, definitely. You know, the these kind of talks, I mean, the one that I would say, you know, it's in boxing, it was Muhammad Ali who was talking like this, you know, and in tennis world, I don't know. What do you think, Dimitri? I don't think anybody would like kind of show up and say, I'm the greatest, because he would be. The problem with tennis is that you lose every week anyway. You know, it's very difficult to kind of, you know, dominate and talk like Ibrahimovic in football. He can talk like this because nobody can really point the finger and said, like, what are you doing? Yeah, I played well, but the team lost. It's not my fault. You know, in tennis, it's very obvious that it's you know, so. And also the locker room will not really take it, you know? So I don't know. Did anybody really kind of dirty talk like this?
Was there
anyone? I don't remember.
Yeah.
You know, I mean, on the guys tour, I could see how maybe some guys can think that, but actually I think the lower level, the lower you go, the more of these guys you find. I think the higher you go, the more people have respect towards their opponents and just understand that, you know, it's, you know, today you can be the greatest player in the world, tomorrow you can, you know, get your ass kicked. So but there was something funny I heard from Andreescu where she said, like, you know, it's I feel like I forgot how to lose, and sure enough someone reminded her quite quickly. But you know, still, like, she played like 5 tournaments in 2 years, and you know, she's still ranked in top 10. So but it was very, very kind of, to me, like it caught my attention that she, you know, she had the confidence to kind of say that. I think, you know, what I find interesting about that, the comment is, you know, I don't know if he really hated Spassky or not, but, you know, just the fact that he's able to say that out loud. I mean, of course, you know, now, if imagine if someone said that on TV, or, you know, he would have to do some major damage control, but I mean, he had the confidence to say that, to put his kind of put himself on the line. I think it just kind of speaks more about his personal confidence in his own game, which I think is very important to have when you're going into the battle in sports. It sounded a little bit more like the,
well, but you know, I mean, sorry, but recently we had the final of Roland Garros, right? And that Ivan Isevich said game day before the match, he said, you know, Novak will for sure. There's no way he's going to lose to Nadal. He's ready, you know. It was weird, you know. It was, I mean, it is a little bit like Goran-like, you know, kind of comment. We know Goran, you know, he just doesn't have filters. He would say anything he feels or thinks. But it was weird to hear it before the final of the Grand Slam, that the coach of the other player would say something like this, especially against Nadal in Roland Garros.
It's not, you know, normal. So, it's not normal at all. Yeah.
No,
it's usual. No. Because in chess it is. From time to time it was like this. I mean,
you play, man, you know, mind games. Now in tennis, it's no. I mean, I don't know. I don't remember.
Even in the past, yeah. Not even nowadays, but not even in the past. Yeah.
I think maybe like Nastase and Connors and these guys, they would do it, you know, in the 70s, 80s, you know.
Yeah.
But
yeah.
Lately, I mean, Connors maybe was the one.
Maybe who was it?
Jimmy Connors.
You think the Connors could say that, yeah?
Yeah, I mean, like, he could say that, but again, there are a lot of players that, you know, didn't really like Jimmy Connors or still have strong opinions about Jimmy. I mean, Marcel Rios maybe could have said something like that, you know, but again, you know, he wasn't very liked. I mean, I think out of all the players, Nick Kyrgios right now is kind of the most outspoken, but I mean, this kind of aligns on, you know, on being, you know, too aggressive for tennis, you know, and I think that they're just, it's such a bad PR, you know, stunt for yourself. I mean, you have to do so much.
Well, you have to be number one or close to number one to say that. I mean, it's, you know, Kyrgios cannot say it. I mean, he's not even like, he seems like he's not even interested.
Well, yeah, right. You know, I think Rafa could easily say that if he wanted to, but of course, you know, he's got too much respect for his opponents. And, you know, honestly, I think if anyone could say that, it probably would have to be him talking about a clay court tournament. You know, because he's just, there's just so much more confidence about him winning the matches on clay. But even with all his, you know, with as much as he's winning, he's still not able to say that. And, you know, sometimes it's good, you know, if you see some, you know, something like that, I think it would, you know, shake up the world a little bit. But yeah, just nowadays it's like, you know, too much political correctness, and, you know, but you would allow yourself to say that, it would be silly.
Okay, thank you so much. So it's clear. And let's see now the game against Maxim Vasilegraf, and see how Ivan, I mean, so humble, you know, and plays the Nadal. I even was thinking about, you know, taking all the notes and checking the correspondence base, which is considered like one of the most advanced series in chess nowadays. The correspondence, they play against each other using a lot of engines and like the computers and all that stuff, like equipment and so on. And yeah, so I will show just fast the game.
Serve and volley defense.
No, but seriously, yeah, exactly. it's like so hard. It's like so many forced lines, and he went on the forced line against Maxim, who is considered like one of the biggest specialists in the world in the Nydorf. And so, okay. And was it called Lockdown Simul? Is it?
Yeah, maybe something.
How many players there were in the
25?
25, yeah. And
he actually lost to somebody. He lost one and he drew two or something like that.
Okay, but it's 25 games online. Yeah, it's also hard. What was the time control? Was it
15? 15 plus 5 or 10, but 15 definitely. It was fast. It was too fast for him. I felt like, you know, to play 25 boards, 15 minutes.
Yeah.
It was not simple.
So you prepared for 10 days?
Yes, yes.
So guys, let's see. I don't know how he did it, because at some point I remember I spent like a few months, but still I couldn't figure out how to play it as black.
I'll tell you a couple times I got lucky and why I got lucky.
Yeah, but I mean, he went for this line. So it's visible, yeah, my screen now?
Yes, we see it, yeah.
You can see it. And also on the stream is visible, right? Aylin, is it visible? Okay. So cool. So let's go, guys, with the game. E4, C5, and knight f3, d6. D4, c takes d4, knight d4, knight f6, knight c3, a6. So it's Nydorf. And now Maxim goes for bishop e3. Actually, he does it, yeah? Were you preparing for this, or?
Yes.
So bishop e3, you was expecting there, like?
Yes. No, I had the lines I wanted to play. Like, okay. If something on the other side happens that doesn't make me play, I would maybe stop and think a bit more. But, you know, this would not stop me from, you know, moving my pieces around. So I knew that, this is now months ago since I played it. I believe I played e5 here.
Okay, so it was the game plan, the c5 stuff.
Yes.
Okay, cool. And knight f3, have you checked here? Because this is one of the tricky moves here as well.
No, I didn't check it.
So knight b3 was
the played game. V3, okay. So...
Okay, so he didn't... Yeah, knight b3 is the main. Actually, I was playing this line against him in one of the FIDE Grand Prix, one of the important...
You played games. As a white.
As white, yeah. We had a very, very long line, which ends like in a kind of slightly unpleasant end game for black. But he knew everything, and he defended very well, and it was a draw. But he was as black. He's as one of the biggest specialists in the world in the Nydorf. Yeah, and so knight b3, bishop e7, f3. Guys, if you want the proper analysis of this game, so you have to go to Agad Matar's channel and check it out, because I think he did really a huge analysis on this one. I just want to show you how strong Ivan is in the Niederf, at least is what I saw in one of the games. I guess he's beating everyone there on the sides, but not telling us. So queen d2, castle short, castle long. And this is one of the main lines in Niederf.
I was happy to see this because this was, as you said, you know, it was in a territory where I just felt like, okay, everything is happening what I was kind of expecting to happen.
Yeah, yeah. So you prepared this b5, right?
Didn't I play with the knight?
No, it was this first. g4,
okay.
b4.
Okay. Well, the one thing that I remembered when I studied Niederf is that I can allow white to move the queenside pawns and not be too stressed about it. You know, this was for me very important. Because yeah. when the guys start pushing the pawns in front of my king, usually I start panicking. It goes before that. But not here only, I felt, okay, it's going to allow me to develop my pieces, you know, and I can develop it before thinking about what's going to happen on my king side, on the black side.
Yeah, yeah. But not only you, believe me, because most of the players who are like kind of tacticians are aggressive players and so on, as black, let's say, or as white, doesn't matter. They don't like when the king is attacked. Which is the thing. And some of the players, they're like defensive
it's
style.
Illogical.
Yeah, no, I mean, there are some players who are defensive style more, and they're okay with the king is attacked, it's fine, I'll just defend everything, take all of the pawns and enjoy it. Like Karchnoy, let's say, for example, that was mentioned many times today on the stream. I mean, he was picking up the pawns and just defending any position more or less. So he was just fine with it. But yeah, so g5, knight h5, rook g1. It's correct, yeah, this, a5. Yeah, but I mean, it's like a great handling of this Niederf. I mean, how is that possible in 10 days? I'm just wondering. I mean, what is the secret? What is the secret, Ivan?
But is this like very unusual lines that I was playing?
Yeah, I mean, but also you are knowing to, where to put all of the pieces, like here, queen c7. So you're coming for queen c6, attacking the knight. And actually, as you see, the engine already shows that, yeah, white is almost lost. And it's move 15, yeah? It's move 15, yeah.
So I had, as I told you, my thinking is this, and I wanted to have the rook on c8. This was when I had envisioned what I would like to achieve.
Yeah.
Right. So this is the position I wanted to get without thinking too much what goes where and what. So this for me was the position I wanted to get, and he allowed me to get there.
Yeah, but I mean, in tennis language, you are like, I don't know, 5-0 here and 40-0, yeah? Like,
no, but I did not. I mean, if you ask me at the moment when I was playing, you are winning now. I was like, what? I'm just putting my pieces in the places that I want them to play. I did not think about, you know, about how do I win this game at all. I was just like, let me survive as long as I can.
Have you spotted that you want to go queen c6 next and just pick up the knight on a4? And it's just winning? Or you just wanted to bring the rook to c8?
No, I just wanted to bring the rook in c8.
So you didn't think about this because that was the
strength. No, not at all. Zero.
And you see that he goes knight a1 just for this reason, right?
Or, no idea. I didn't see it. No.
You didn't see it, yeah? Because he goes knight a1 in order to protect the knight on a4. Because after queen c6, he has the only, like, the only this pawn.
That's a new to me.
Yeah, so he was protecting the knight. That's the point. And knight a1, otherwise, you don't want to do because it's like, I mean, it's kind of ugly move.
It did look funny, I have to say. Yeah. But I thought he was protecting more the pawn on c2 rather than.
Also, you had a great respect probably towards him. So you saw that maybe it's kind of a great positional decision, is it? So you went through fc8, right? Here?
Yes.
Fc8. Yes. b3. Just guys, for your understanding, the position is completely lost, and it's the like one of the top players in the world getting this position in 15 moves against Ivan in the simultaneous exhibition match. And like white is completely lost here. And Ivan goes for the best move now. He goes for knight f4. Yeah, b3, knight f4. Okay, knight c5 is a bit better here, but knight f4 is also winning. Because with this knight on a1, I mean, black can do whatever they want. Now he sacrifices the pawn here. I mean, white can take twice on f4, but the knight will be so ugly there on a1 that black is just completely winning. So knight f4, king b1. Maxim doesn't know what to do, but yeah, I mean, I can understand him in this position. It's just really bad. Now, so king b1, rook ab8. Okay, now I see your plan. Yes, you just wanted to establish all kind of rooks here, attacking the king more or less, yeah. And there are a lot of prospects, like, because knight c5 is coming and all that stuff. So rook a b8, rook c1. And now you could win by knight c5. Like, you're very close to winning after this. But you went for what? What was the move? D5. Okay, okay. Okay, Yugoslavian style, yeah. Just playing for mate, I guess. So mate. Takes f4. Yeah, yeah, hopefully. I mean, there is, you know, with this knight on a1, black can do whatever they want, more or less, for a long time. Until
black,
the knight
black if you play black, not if I play black.
Well, I mean, okay, yeah, but still, I mean, you did everything perfect for now.
No, I have to say that I really like the position because it's comfortable. Like, he was not attacking anything, you know. Of course, I see the knight on a1, you know, it's nothing to worry about.
Yeah, so he takes f4, he takes d5. I think he was at least happy here because he got the pawn back. I mean, not back, but his pawn up, more or less, at least some compensation for this bad knight. Okay, queen d6 was close to winning, but bishop f5 is still good that you did. So, Ivan, it's good that we didn't play today against you, I must tell you, because nobody prepared, not Kramnik nor me. Yeah, so bishop d3 takes d3, c takes d3. You are still slightly better, but already now he's more or less, I mean, kind of equalizing because the knight is coming back. So you probably had to go this like stuff of queen d6 and so on, but play just without d5 was completely winning with this knight c5 that I showed here, like before. What was it? Just here, yeah. No, just here, yeah. Sorry. Yeah, just this d5 was too much, maybe. Your position is completely winning. You can go g6, knight c5, whatever. Just dominating. So you went for this, knight takes d3, c takes d3, queen d6. Did you feel that you are winning, or can he collapse on time, or?
I did not try to do anything other than survive as long as possible.
Okay. So he went rook c6.
I started to panic here a bit because I felt like there were some tricks coming up, and I was not sure if I was ready for it.
Yeah, you could win here as well by queen takes d5. I mean, it's like close to winning this position. Still, he would defend, of course. I mean, as much as he could, but the position is really collapsing.
I don't know. It felt like, for me, it felt like it's too obvious to take it. So it must be something wrong.
Yeah, so you took this one, d takes c6. And now I saw on Antonios, I mean, he was showing here that knight b6 is a good move. Maybe knight d5 is a bit stronger. Yeah, actually giving a good advantage to black. But you went knight b6, still a good move. Knight b6. And knight takes b6. Rook takes b6. Queen c2, is it? No. Let me see. Just after c takes d3 here. So you went, no, you actually went queen e5 right here. So queen d6 was the move, was the best move here, queen d6. So you went queen e5. This is not that great because you gave him the possibility to go rook g1, attacking your queen. Yes. Yeah, and then you went back. So you could play the same with the rook on g1, simply just having great advantage to black. So queen d6, rook c6. He probably saw that he's winning at least this one game out of 25. He was much better. So in this position, I think he was very happy because he got the pawn up, and certainly you are supposed to make some mistakes here. But after d takes c6, knight b6. Now I will show you the trick by Ivan, and Ivan has to tell us, I mean, if he saw it or not.
Just I did not see it at all. I can tell you already, but yeah.
Rook b6, queen c2. And now you went rook takes c6. Have you seen rook takes c7 here?
I did not. I mean, I remember then later people asked me, I think if he would have played this, I would have lost.
So you would because do what here?
Like, I would not see. I would not find the king f8. No chance.
But you remember the king f8 was
yes,
here.
Yes.
Yeah, but so guys, I mean, after this rook takes c7, there was a deadly win. Like, I mean, the last shot simply by black here, king f8. And when Agadmater showed this on one of the streams about this game, I was impressed because I saw that was the point of your combination here with this rook takes c7 and king f8. And it's really, really tricky thing. I mean, this king f8 because it just wins for black.
Yeah, but why he didn't play for it.
So, yeah, that's why he didn't play rook takes c7. He saw it.
Yeah, but that's what I said. Like, also later, you know, we spoke. I don't remember if we spoke about it. Somebody asked him about it. And I think he over kind of estimated me here, you know, because if he went for this trick, there's no way I would play king f8 there. I would take the queen for sure.
And be mated there. I'm not mated, yeah. But king e8. And,
most likely. Yeah. I mean, you know, now it's hard to say what I would, but for me, you know, to find really king f8 there, it's just too much to ask.
Okay, so queen
e2. But he didn't go for it, so.
Yeah, queen e2, rook c7, which is a strong move as well. Bishop f8 was winning. But yeah. Guys, it's impressive. I mean, to be honest, because when I wanted to know the E1's chess level, I mean, I was impressed seeing this game, seriously. Because I mean,
no, but sorry, can I ask you? So is it? I mean, I'm just defending the bishop here. I mean, you said it's very strong. What else can I play?
You can play bishop f8 here as well. I mean, just getting it back there. And yeah,
of course. But you know, like people ask me, you know, did you cheat? Did you use the engine? It's like, I did not feel like I was playing some amazing moves. You know, first of all, why would I cheat? Like, what am I trying to gain here? You know? And yeah, second is that it's for me, the position that I wanted to find myself in after 15, 18 moves was the neither position, right?
Yeah.
And still today, you know, if somebody plays to me E4, I'll try to achieve the same line. It's just that with this particular line that MVL played, I was just able to get there.
No, but I have seen a lot of your games as well. I mean, on the Agadmatter stream where you played you played some chess matches. Yes. So I saw your level, yeah, in general, the kind of level that you showed there in the games. I was impressed
because level
I saw
it's that... good until I blunder, and then it's
okay.
Not.
But that's okay, Ivan. But that's normal, yeah. I mean, it's like the thing, yeah. If you are training more, you're getting stronger in chess. I mean, it's not your certainly it's not your professional thing. I mean, the chess, yeah, in tennis. You are much stronger. But for me, let's say, for example, if I would play tennis, I mean, against the top player, I think after the first serve already, I would just give the racket to the arbiter, yeah. And leave and just say, okay, thank you. Because I have seen some of the professional tennis players serving. And I mean, I don't know how to get the ball back.
No, but I can't compare.
Just to see the ball is the problem. To see the ball is the problem, yes. You know, for the amateur. So here is the same. I mean, you are playing against the top player in the world. So it could be, it seems that you should lose, like, I don't know, in 20 moves or 15 moves. But in fact, it's a huge game and with a lot of pressure on Maxim. So, so you went rook c7. So guys, now we'll see how it ended. So yeah, rook c7, knight c2. You remember the end of the game, yeah, here.
I remember I pushed the pawn for wrong reasons, but it was an amazing move.
Queen e5, queen c6, attacking the knight on c2. Still problems for Maxim. Rook c1, the best move he finds, Maxim here, to defend the position at least. Rook c1, bishop d6. Black is again close to winning, I would say. But still it's hard. For now it's already not so easy. Queen e4, queen takes e4, f takes e4. Queen c3 was kind of dominating here. a4 is coming and all that stuff. Tricky for white. But okay, queen takes e4. F takes e4, rook c3, knight e1, and f3.
Well, and this is the move that everybody talked about, because
rook takes c3 and f2, yeah?
Yeah, because I moved the pawn to open my bishop. That was really my only goal. I really did not think about promoting, you know, and if in case I don't know if I would, let's say here, what did he play here? He moved
knight f3. He did
knight f3. He did, yes, because he said like if he takes the rook, basically it's over, yeah. Right?
Yeah, if he takes the rook, then f2 is the move. Yeah.
Yeah, exactly. But I'm not sure if I would move f2 here. You know, this is I would maybe consider it. I mean, obviously, that if I think about it, you see it that it's winning because you're just queening, right? But I cannot say what I would do in case he would have taken, you know, my rook on c3.
Very humble, but I think that you would go f2, actually, because it's like already there, it's kind of clear that f2 is the possibility and you can promote. Is it? Like after rook c3, it's already visible that f2 is the possibility.
No. Yes, of course.
Yeah. So once the position arises, it's also another story, if you think about it. So he went what? I mean, he went knight takes f3, trying to make a draw somehow. Rook takes d3. And rook f1, is it? Yeah. No, rook d3 and e5. Okay, e5. And did you think about playing for a win here, or you just saw the draw is good?
You're crazy. What do you mean playing for the win?
I don't know. I mean, why getting ambitious during the game? It's happened to me many times, even when I was playing tennis. And I had some bad opponent for me, like in tennis. And I was always like feeling that if I push a little bit more, I will win. But still, it was ending, I mean, all the time, like in 6-2.
If you can prepare the openings, you can try to stay stable and try not to do something stupid. But end games is probably where the level is the biggest difference between the top players and the average players, right?
Yeah.
So, I mean, I was just happy not to get there.
Yeah, so you went bishop e7, bishop f8 was still close to winning. So bishop e7, because, I mean, here it's what we discussed actually earlier on the stream, is that the bishop prevails over the knight in this type of positions, and with a rook together especially, and also white is having a lot of weaknesses like e5, h4, and the king is more vulnerable. So yeah, bishop f8 was close to it. Okay, bishop e7 is fine as well. So bishop e7, Maxim went rook f1, defending the knight and trying to bring the king in the center, at least keeping the position closer to equal. So rook e3, king c2. Okay, bishop c5 is not so easy to find, so you went king g7. King d2, bishop c5. Now it's okay, just defending the rook. And now he went king d1. And okay, let's be fair, you didn't want to beat him, yeah? You just didn't want. You just said, okay, I mean, let him enjoy, yeah?
No, so because I mean, here king f8... I was happy to see that he doesn't have anything. And you know, like when he started to repeat and when he actually said, like, I'm happy to offer the draw, I was like, what? You're crazy.
Yeah, but that's the thing. Because in this position, let's say you are having a huge advantage, but you decided to call it a day and just make a draw here because you went king g8. I think he was very happy also with the result. Guys, here, the plan would be just bringing the king here to e6. And black's position is kind of dominating here. And yeah, actually, Compi is already showing like white is almost, I mean, black is almost winning. So here, Ivan decided to go king g8, and he says he was happy about this repetition. What did Maxim say afterwards? Was he impressed? Was he praising you? Did he talk to the players or you specifically?
Yeah, I think he was streaming. I was just listening to his comments. We did not speak directly. He was streaming, so I could listen to his comments while he was playing. You know, he was there. Yeah, he was just happy to. He said like, well, if Ivan is happy with the draw, I'm happy too, because I cannot win. You know, so I was like, okay, fine. Thank you very much. No, it was, I was extremely happy, extremely happy. It was during the like middle of the lockdown, you know, everybody was feeling bad. And it was something that made this lockdown to me a bit nicer.
Ivan, I think for Dmitry it was the first express chess lesson. Probably he just thinks that what are these guys talking about these positions and stuff? What is this Snyder thing? And either how boring it is or how cool Ivan is playing. And he only knew you playing like super well on the court, of course. But now he sees that you can play against the top players in the world and on their field, actually. It's like playing Knyder against Maxim Vasilyagraf is like, I don't know, playing King's Indian against me as black or something like that. So it's kind of similar thing.
Let's try that. Let's do that for the next stream.
I think that as Dmitry is, as he said, I mean, his internet is not working that well nowadays. We will have to prepare with him. We will have to prepare with him. As I'm also in Moscow. And we will have to prepare some kind of, you know, chess opinions and stuff to play against you at some point. And use Kramnik as well, I mean, as the help for us, you know. I mean, he's very good at the openings. And we will prepare as much as we can and try to beat you once. I mean, we will get to the match. We'll bring Dmitry to the match. I will coach him, or Vladimir will coach him, and we will see what happens to it, hopefully. Dmitry, thank you so much for joining. I know that this chess part was... maybe not the most funny for you, but thank you so much for your, you know, for your, I cannot say strong opinions, but you were directly speaking everything that is on your mind. And it's so, so nice. Thank you so much. He actually said that Roger Federer is the greatest player ever. And yeah, I mean, I completely agree with it because I'm his biggest fan and certainly hope that he has a great 2021 season. And Ivan, of course, thank you so much for joining today. Thank you for this great evening.
Thanks for having me.
Yeah, it was most pleasurable evening for me. I mean, in a long, long time in this lockdown. Thank you so much, guys. Thank you very much. And good luck to all of you. And,
thank you.
Good luck for the next season. Thank you so much.
Thank you very much. Till the next one.
Till the next one. Bye-bye. Thank you.
Cheers. Thanks, bud. Yep. Bye.
Bye. Yeah. Okay, guys. Thank you so much for being with us today. It was, great pleasure to have Mr. Ljubicic, Vladimir, and Dmitry on the stream. I hope you enjoyed. And really nice that these people from the very, very top of the tennis world, they are there. They like chess. They enjoy talking to the chess players, top chess players, and any chess players around the world. And thank you so much. I think it brings a lot of attention towards the game. And hopefully till the next time, we'll have a lot of interesting guests. But for me, this was one of the most precious guests ever, because as a fan of Roger, you know, and you have seen a lot of my Twitter and Instagram and everything, I've shared a lot of posts from Roger's matches and so on, and was trying to get as much as I can during my tournaments to watch the, live matches and so on of Roger, and even had a lot of sleepless nights and was super upset, especially when he lost matches. It was probably affecting my play, probably in a good way, because I was more aggressive in my games afterwards. But certainly, guys, thank you so much. It was Ivan Ljubicic, one of the best players in the world, former world number 3, Davis Cup holder, and he has so many titles that if I start to mention them now, we will never finish the stream. And since 2015, he's coach of Roger Federer, and up to now, he's coaching Roger and preparing him for the 2021 season, and hopefully Australian will be a successful one. Thank you so much for watching. Good luck to everyone who loves chess and tennis. Bye-bye.